rush on. Holy fire, burn with breath of God, revive us. Thank you.
amazing, amazing, amazing grace. What 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 amazing, amazing, amazing grace. And you flood my soul with the glory of your presence. You flood my soul with the goodness of your grace. You flood my soul with the glory of your presence. You flood my soul with the goodness of your grace. Amazing, amazing grace. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. Oh, what love. What amazing, amazing, amazing love. What amazing, amazing, amazing love. What amazing, amazing, amazing love that fills my soul. Me whole purchase. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. What amazing, amazing, amazing grace. And what amazing, amazing, amazing grace.
Your faithfulness beyond compare. Your faith. faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness beyond compare.
Almighty. Oh, mighty, mighty, mighty. Oh, most mighty, mighty, mighty.
Your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare.
Almighty. Almighty God.
Your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Lord, your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Oh, your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Oh, your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare. Lord, your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Oh, your faithfulness is beyond. Lord, your faithfulness reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness is beyond compare.
Corozan and Ginges, Nina, I knew him. He shined Boromin, Limalamus, Kuramai, I know Niniu, Kian Saibo, Mammy. Kursai, my inundarni, Namni. Moyon mus, Barababro. Bam dina runo, babakar sizan zozizal miende. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross of Calvary. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood you shed for me. For this work of love divine, grace, 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 grace. For this work of love divine, as you Jesus Mombera. The blood of Jesus Christ, the Almighty God, cleanses me. Oh, the crown of glorious victory placed upon my head when the Almighty God came up, when he rose up from the dead. Oh, Jesus, Lord Jesus, oh, Jesus is the name. Oh, Jesus, Lord Jesus, Christ Jesus is the name. Oh, Jesus, my Lord Jesus, oh, Christ Jesus is the name. Oh, Jesus, the Lord Jesus, Christ Jesus is the name. The name above all names, Jesus, Lord and Savior. Thank you for the cross. The cross, the cross of Calvary. Thank you for the blood. Oh, the blood. Oh, the blood you shed for me. Yeah. Thank you for the cross. Oh, oh, the cross. Oh, the cross of Calvary. Oh, thank you for the blood. Oh, oh, the blood. Oh, your blood you shed for me. Oh, the name is Jesus, my Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus Christ, the name. The name is Jesus, the Lord Jesus, Jesus Christ, my victory. The name above all names, the name of the King, Almighty God, Jesus.
Thank you. Father, all we want, all we need to reign and rule in this life is found in your presence and in your glory. It's found at your feet. It's found in your word. It's found in your holiness. It's found in your truth. It's found in your love. It's found in your power. It's found in everything you are, and that's the only place we want to be. Only place we want to be. The only place we want to be, even this night, in this moment, Lord, according to your plans and your purposes and your pursuits. Lord, let not anything that comes forth be of my opinion or anyone else's opinion. All that counts is what you say. All that counts is who you are. All that counts is your truth, your revelation, your anointing, your glory, your gifts, your fruit, your everything. So we are so dependent upon you, Holy Spirit, this night to bring forth that revelation from the Word of God anointed by the Holy Ghost that will divide even the soul and spirit, the joints and the marrow, and it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. For Lord, you've called us this night to be a trumpet. You've called us this night to speak forth as the very oracles of the living God. And Lord, that's where we want to be. That's exactly where we want to be and what we want to do. And we thank you, Holy Spirit, that you move, that you hover over your people, that you draw, that you woo, that you reveal, that you convict, that you correct, that you exhort, that you bring comfort, that you bring encouragement, that you bring change of direction, and you bring a sharpening, and you bring repentance, and you bring out of us who we were created to be in Christ Jesus. And Lord, we give you all praise and all glory, for it all belongs unto you both now and forevermore. In the wonderful name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen and amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Once again, what an awesome presence of God in this house, and how honored we are to be here. I tell you, this might be your first service of the day, but this is my second or third of the day. And I tell you, the Lord was just ministering to me even this morning as I was working on this message in such a profound way. And then when we hooked up for fellowship with your pastors, I thought, Pastor Mark's going to wonder if I'm in sin or something, because the whole time he's crying, I'm trying to hold back the tears. Just because when you're at all sensitive to the Holy Spirit, and what's coming is such a confirmation. And it's just powerful, and it's holy, and it's adjusting things, and it's letting you know that things the Lord's beginning to reveal to you in a profound way that he's revealing to many, as it should be. And it was just a holy, holy, holy time. And before I bring the word, I'm just going to tell you that there were parts that were a correcting time. And as he was just talking about certain things that I have maybe, one in particular, that I have maybe been taught a little differently, a lot differently. and I just sat and listened and asked, and what about this, and what about this? And I tell you, as the word of God came forth, the immediate adjustment was made. You know, you can be taught by some of the greatest names, some of the greatest personalities, and people who totally love God. And people who were right on in 99% of it. But if 1% isn't Bible, we need to make a correction. And I did that immediately on the spot. I would have come just for that. And there's another reason I'm telling you that. Because I expect the Lord's going to do that with some things with you tonight. Absolutely. And as he does, don't pull, oh, I already know this, or nah, this is too legalistic, or this is too whatever. The Holy Spirit is going to rearrange some things tonight so that you are exactly where you need to be walking with him. Remember that first night as we started out talking about the triumphant church without spot or wrinkle. Yeah. the glorious church, doing mighty exploits, marching and walking and signs. That's what we all want, right? Signs and wonders and healings and miracles and looking like Jesus and talking like Jesus. Well, there's another area that I imagine not this church, because of the way your pastor teaches and preaches so much. But evidently, for God to want me to come along and be another word in this area, evidently we all got some things we can come up to in this area. But in general, in the body of Christ, we're in churches all over the land, let me put it that way. This is almost never being preached anymore. We're going to talk about holiness. We're going to talk about being a peculiar and a separated people. We're going to talk about repentance. We're going to talk about, should the Holy Ghost allow, because I've ended up with about two major sermons in one, and I'm still asking him how to do this, and he will show me. But we're also going to talk about what I call, we were just singing about grace. There is nothing more wonderful. The only reason we're all here tonight, the only reason we have salvation, the only reason that we're going to live eternally is because of that amazing, amazing, amazing grace. And because it's so wonderful, because it's so precious, because it's so holy, we cannot allow it to be cheapened by some man-made or worse demonic doctrine from hell that would pervert that holy, awesome, loving, true message of grace. And we cannot allow some political correctness. We think that's only out there in politics, or that's only out there in some other field. It has permeated the church to try to say what's acceptable to people. We're going to talk about that word tolerance a little bit before it's all over. How many visitors do we have here tonight? Anyone who's a visitor to the church? Or anybody who would admit it after the way we started out? All right. So it looks like it's the church here tonight. And you know, I'm not going to get as lengthy as I really thought I would on the first subject we're starting out with, but I'm going to touch on it anyway. Several years ago, I was in the nation of Norway. And I had been there many, many, many times, more than any other nation I've been to, probably 15, 16 times. I've kind of lost count now. And I've been in several places all over the nation, but that night we were in Bergen, large auditorium, television, going into 160-some nations. And it's Friday night, we've had joy, we've had the glory, we've prophesied all week. I was there for a whole week. I mean, now it's going to be Friday night. It's going to be the blowout service. That's what I think. That's what everybody thinks. And early in the day, more distinctive than I've ever heard the voice of the Lord as far as telling me something to preach. It was, change everything. I want you to preach on hell tonight. And I'm like, say what? I mean, how about the river, the fire? I'll give you a whole line you can pick from, Lord. I want you to preach on hell. Oh, Lord, I'm in Norway. I'm in Scandinavia, where this greasy grace message has permeated everything. It's the Friday night blowout meeting. And sure enough, we have more people than we had the whole week. And I thought, but the majority of these have already been to the altar. They've already been under the glory. We start preaching on hell. And before I could finish the altar call, they came running from all sides to come to the altar and repent and truly give their lives to Jesus. And I'm looking out at a crowd that some of them I know from other places in Norway that are the deacons of the church. They're the leaders of all the churches. And they're down there getting born again. And I made it clear so nobody would misunderstand. And they were down there getting born again. And they needed to be down there getting born again.
True.
And in that group, unbeknown to me, well, I recognized the man, but I didn't know what was going on in his heart. There was a man at the altar who, he was an American who had been living in Norway for many years. I found out that he had married a Norwegian lady and they divorced, but he stayed on in Norway. And When I first held meetings in Norway, that was one of the men who got touched the most. I thought, blessed the most. I thought, rolling on the floor, a hilarious joy coming forth. He loved the river of God. He loved the anointing. And then it was like that a couple of times. In fact, he was calling me the mother of the faith, you know, and da-da-da-da-da-da. Then I go back the third or fourth time, and he's only running television cameras, but I can tell there is a complete difference in his demeanor. He's mad. He's scowling. He won't ever come up. Even on the nights he has off, he won't ever even come to the meetings. So I asked somebody, what happened to this man? They said, nobody knows. He's bitter. He's angry. And he won't tell anybody why. He has nothing to do with the services, except he's still hired to be behind the camera. I tried talking to him. He wouldn't talk to me. Nothing. And now I've been back there a couple of times since, still nothing. That night on hell, I saw he was the first man. Just his shoulders were heaving. He was just weeping. He was just screaming out, oh God, save me. I got a letter a few weeks later that he had just been diagnosed with terminal cancer. And he's saying, Pastor Debbie, please pray for me. They say I got days to live. I mean, I just heard about it long distance. And I mean, we could get into it. I didn't get to go there, lay hands on him. I don't know where his faith was at. I don't know. I'm leaving that alone. But I want you to hear this. I heard that he went on to be with the Lord. But the last thing he said, laying in the bed with tears running down his face, was, tell Miss Debbie that if she wouldn't have preached that message on hell, I would be slipping in there right now. Wow. And I just rejoice. He was one who kept telling everybody, I'm okay. Leave me alone. I'm okay. Don't want to talk about it. I'm okay. I'm fine. Ever heard people say, me and the big guy are fine? Right. Those kind of terms that you're like, just using that blasphemous term, you're a long way from fine. Yeah. Right. Me and the old man, me and the big guy, me and, yeah.
Right.
Anyway, I want to touch on a few things here tonight. Not only so, I know your pastor has preached on this, but I'm going to come right out and ask a church, a faithful church, who's been in revival, been in everything, but I'm still going to ask, do you know the moment that you made a decision for Jesus and repented of your sin and said, Lord, forgive me. Wash me in your blood. Make me whiter than snow. I have sorrowful repentance that I grieved you, that you had to take my sin. And Lord, please come into my heart. Please give me new life. I confess you, Jesus Christ, not only as my Savior, but Lord of my life. And you came away from there knowing where you were headed south, you're headed north. You came away from there. I'm a brand new creation. What I used to love, I now hate. What I used to hate, I now love. Yeah. Or do you say, I don't know, I sort of assimilated into the church. I sort of just, you know, No. That doesn't cut it. Do you have a clear, distinct memory of when you bent on that knee and, oh God, I know I'm a sinner and I repent? We can't come to God just any time we choose. I'm not talking about Him having these favorites and preordaining some to be saved and others not to. I'm not talking about that kind of Calvinism. But I'm talking about the Bible tells us that the Holy Spirit draws us. And even this night, there isn't a single person here by accident tonight. You were drawn, you were wooed by the Holy Ghost Himself to have a personal invitation for change that stays throughout all of eternity. John 6:44 says, no man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him. To reject Christ time after time after time is a very dangerous thing. To play with the things of God, as we have many doing today, is an extremely dangerous thing. Yes, thinking, well, I know, I have memory. There are preachers doing that. I have memory of how to move in the Holy Ghost. I have memory, you know, I've studied the Word before. I can come back anytime I want to. I can get serious any moment, any night. No. They are deceiving themselves, and they're up for a rude awakening. This is a subject that I'm on tonight. I'm going to have to stay a little bit close to these notes because the Lord gave me a lot to cover tonight. And if I step in and step over and get away from them, I could be off to the races with this kind of a crowd that pulls on the anointing of the Holy Ghost. This subject, hell, repentance, holiness, conviction, it's a subject almost never preached anymore. Mainline churches don't even believe it anymore. Someday they will, and it'll be too late. They all like to say, oh, it's the goodness of God that leads man to salvation. Yes, that's a Bible verse, but it's not the only one in the Bible. Right. It also says in Romans 11:22, behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell severity, but toward thee goodness. If, everybody say if.
If.
If thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shall be cut off. Yeah. Is that the word of God? Is that the word of the Holy Bible?
Yes.
Well, God must not have heard this new doctrine that everybody else is getting today.
He didn't.
That once you say a prayer, you're in for good no matter how you live. I guess he didn't say that because he said, if you stay in him, in his goodness. We can't pick and choose which part of the Bible we want to believe. That's how we get false doctrines. Not everybody who says they're a Christian is. And my, if you've ever walked in an hour where everybody you talk to is, unless they come right out and say, I'm Muslim or I'm Buddhist or I'm an atheist. If you don't get those responses, you almost get from any American, oh yeah,
sure.
Yeah. God didn't send a religion to the world to save us, but a redeemer. Called Jesus Christ. You can go to church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, every Friday night, every revival meeting, and still go to hell.
Yes, you can.
Religion can inform you, but it cannot transform you. Only Jesus Christ can change a heart. Not all the studying in the world, even though we're to study after we meet Jesus to show ourselves approved. But I'm telling you, you can study, you can have every degree behind your name, and unless you have an intimate relationship
Amen.
With the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, you have nothing.
Amen.
You can be just like the Pharisee, do all the good things. The Pharisee, remember, went down his list. Remember the Pharisee making fun of the tax collector? Oh, thank God I'm not like him. He goes down his list, how proud he was for doing everything right. He prays. He's in the temple. He thinks he has right standing with God and had the audacity to pick out the tax collector in the temple and say, I thank you that I'm not like that guy. The Bible says that the tax collector was in such godly sorrow. He's beating his chest. Oh God, I'm a sinner. That's the place everybody has to come to. He was in remorse. He was in repentance. And he was the only one of them that walked out that day in right relationship with God. The Pharisee didn't have one. He might have had one with his ordination, with his denomination, with his reputation. He might have had one with the television station, I might add. He might have had one with everybody else. But he didn't have a right standing with the living God. A lot of people go to church in America for a social standing. They like the atmosphere of the church. It's sort of like therapy. A nice safe haven. I like the people. I like the participation. I kind of like the music. It doesn't work that way.
Right.
They think I've made a mess of things all week. I'll get in on the weekend, make it right, kind of try to appease God, appease my own conscience. It doesn't work that way. Jesus said in Matthew 7:21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. If we went no further tonight, that covers it. We will go further, but that covers it. Oh, it's not work. Who does? That sounds like works to me. Who does something? Does my will. Obeys my commandments. Does what I ask you to. Leaves alone the things I ask you to leave alone. The person who does that is the only one who's going to be there. Not everyone. On judgment day, Lord, we prophesied in your name. Nope, I never knew you. Prophesied? Man, that doesn't sound like a denominational person to me. That sounds like some sort of charismatic Pentecostal full gospel person. Nobody else is even going to run around saying they prophesied in his name. That sounds to me like somebody who's set in some revival meetings sometime.
Yeah.
Sounds to me like somebody who knows something about the gifts of the Spirit.
Oh, that's good.
And he says, I'll say I never knew you. The prophet Isaiah says in Isaiah 64:6, all our righteousness is as filthy rags. God compares our righteousness before we're saved to His holiness, and it comes up as filthy rags. When you understand the holiness of God, you understand what Jeremiah said in 17:9, who can know the human heart? It is wicked and deceitful. Newsflash, God is holy, and unless we are in Him, we are not. Right. No matter how many good works we do, no matter what kind of a family we came from, it's only through Jesus Christ. Acts 4:12, nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. In John 14:6, I tell you what, I'm making up for last night. Last night I quoted a couple verses and that was it. Tonight you're going to hear the word, the word, the word. So buckle or unfasten your seatbelts, however you want to look at it. Acts 4:12, nor is there salvation in any other, Oprah. I mean, any other. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. John 14:6, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He didn't say, I am a way, I am the way. He didn't say, I am a life, I am the life. He didn't say, I am a truth among many truths, I am the only truth. No one can have right relationship with the Father except through Christ. You might say, well, I believe in God. You try witnessing to somebody that's straight. Yeah, I believe in God. The Bible says so do the demons. They even tremble. They know enough to know He exists. They know enough to know who He is. It's not believing in just that He existed. It's believing on Him. And when we believe on Him, we believe on every verse, every word, every jot, every tittle. When we believe on Him, we believe He's holy. When we believe on Him, we believe we could be like Him because He lives on the inside of us. When we believe on Him, we walk like Jesus, talk like Jesus, smell like Jesus. Hallelujah. There's a lot of people say, I believe He existed. I even believe a lot of His stuff is true. Believing in Jesus doesn't save a person. Got to believe on Him and everything He represents. You know, I heard somebody, I could just claim this tonight, but I can't even remember if I heard it, read it, or what. But the Lord kind of caused me to remember it a while back. They talked about missing heaven by 18 inches. They said they had read in a medical journal that the difference between the head and the heart is 18 inches. That's just how far people miss heaven by. 18 inches. Just trying to draw their own conclusions right up here with their heart never grabbing hold and believing. So much theology and doctrine that is askew. Because we all tend to read books about the Bible instead of the Bible. We tend to listen to authors instead of the author. People believing they can get saved when they want to, when I'm old, when I'm done with my sin. John 15:16 says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you. We're chosen by God, folks. Salvation is when we're chosen by God. You get to come in and believe, I've chosen you, I love you, I've searched you out. By divine appointment. Hallelujah. Again, you are not here by accident. And I know some of you are already tempted to tune out. I can't believe it. She's preaching our church a salvation message. We who operate in the gifts of the Spirit. And we who... No, you just hang on. Just hang on for a while. If today were the only day you heard the gospel preached, you will never be able to stand in eternity and say, no one taught me how to accept Christ. Jesus said in Luke 12:9, but he who denies me before men will be denied before the angels of God. If you confess me publicly before men, I'll confess you openly before the Father. What you do with Jesus on earth determines on what he does with you throughout all eternity. One day you and I both will stand before him on that judgment day. And 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. So let's do a little self-evaluation tonight, okay? To make sure we're all right with God.
Yes.
1 second, really 1 milliliter of a second, but I'm just going to say 1 second after you die. Are you going to be with him?
Yes.
Well, that's a good answer. I can tell I'm in a good church tonight. You'd be shocked how many people I can tell stop and think about that. Where are you going to believe? Be, because of what you believe. There really is a heaven and hell, folks. And you might say, you're preaching to the choir. But I was just talking with your pastors today about people I have preached with that I find out are now being persuaded that hell isn't really like we think. It's sort of a cleansing. It's sort of this. It's sort of that. And when I try to nail them on it, they'll say, well, you know, I'm just not going to talk about it further. I don't think we know enough about it to really preach on it. Somebody should have told Jesus that, who spent more time teaching and preaching about hell than he did heaven. And set that in the Bible for our example to preach on.
It is amazing.
We're going to be one place or the other forever and ever and ever and ever. And we got to make the decision now while we're alive. Nobody will be in heaven or hell by accident, but by deliberate choice. You don't just fall in either place. But by deliberate choice, people are saying, I mean, they're everywhere. And you're going to hear this as you're out witnessing, and I'm sure many of you already have. I can't believe you believe in a God of love and tell people there's a hell, a day of judgment. Guess what, folks? I didn't write the Bible. He did. He wrote all of it. And if all of it's true, not just the part we like, and if it is the Word of God from the first word in Genesis to the last word in Revelation, and if all of it is inspired, and all of it is infallible, and all of it was written as the Holy Ghost came upon the prophets of old, if it is what it says it is, the inspired, infallible Word of God, that He's the one that tells us there is a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. We can study the ministry of Jesus and try to deny hell, but realize we can't as we study His ministry. Again, He spoke on it more than heaven. And you and I need to love people enough to tell them eternity is real. And you need to make a choice. I was telling your pastor today that, how many remember Richard Moore? I know he's been here recently. I don't know if he's ever shared this with you or not, but I've heard him share it many times publicly, and I've talked to him about it. You know how he got saved? In school, there was a guy who kept giving him one of those kind of what we would call today old-fashioned, many would say sort of legalistic little tracks. Yeah, those chick flacks. That's what they were called back then, chick tracks. And they would have like these animated, you know, things in them. And it was basically, he would show him one about burning in hell. And he'd hand it to him and he'd say, he called him Ricky. That's what he was known by back then, I guess. And he'd say, Ricky, you're going to hell. And he just, you can imagine. And he'd come up to him the next time, Ricky, you're going to hell. And give him another one. And he'd throw it back at him. I'm tired of your going to hell stuff. And I don't know how long this went by. And all of a sudden, conviction, he would begin to shake. I'm going to hell. I'm going to hell. I'm not saying that that is your first witnessing technique. I'm not saying that's what we all do. But I'm just saying, for it's the Word of God, and it got that man who has seen people come to Christ all over the world. But today you would hear, no, you can't do it that way. You shouldn't even mention that. There is a hell to shun. God's not going to send anyone there. If you go there, it's your choice. The Bible tells us that God did everything in His power to make sure that no human being will ever go to hell. Matthew tells us that it wasn't even created for us. It was created for the devil and his demons. God didn't go, boy, I'd sure get a kick out of people who missed the mark. No, 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 no. But in His righteousness and in His holiness and in His divine love. Can you imagine getting to heaven and there's the sins that we see going on all over the world, the rape, the murder, the hunger, the starvation, the torture, the beheading, all this stuff we hear about. Can you imagine? Oh, you're here too. We would have no heaven. And He said, I'm going to do everything. So not one, I don't care how wicked they've been. Nobody has to go there. Amen. And people still go, I will. I will go there. I will deny you. I will resist you. Relationship is a choice. You can't force relationship on anyone. Has anybody ever tried it? Somebody's either going to reciprocate your love or they're going to reject it. God didn't make any robots. He didn't say, I love you, so therefore you're going to have to love me. I'm so glad my husband and I's relationship isn't like that, where he says, I hate to do this, but God's making me kiss you. I hate to do this, but He said, I got to say, I love you. No, he reciprocates that love, and I reciprocate it back. That's what God wanted from his creation. So people will either accept or reject. And the Bible says he who has the Son of life has, he who has the Son has life, and he who is not the Son does not have life. If you've never repented of sin, you may even have said, okay, Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. But if you never repented of your sin, if you never said, I'm in sin, and Lord, I know that's what you died for. I'm asking you to forgive me. I'm asking you to take it, and I forsake it. I run the other way. If you have never done that, you're not going to be there.
That's right.
He presents the opportunity, but if we reject that, we're never going to be there. You can't do something neutral about Jesus. I'm not saying no, not saying yes. That doesn't work in his kingdom. You either accept or reject him. I don't care how good of a person you are. You're not saved because you're religious, even if you go to the best church in the world. But because you have repented of your sin and made Jesus Lord of your life, the Bible tells us to examine ourselves. Hell, a place of utter despair. I tell you what, when I've been in Burundi, Africa, in many other African and Asian places, I've visited prisons. But Burundi, Africa has got to be the worst of where I've been. And they asked us to come in there, and I tell you, we saw hundreds saved every time we go in there. But I just asked the Lord, Holy Ghost, I'm not exaggerating here. Holy Ghost, help me not to vomit while I'm preaching because of the stench. Help me. I mean, it is so bad. They are not supplied any clothing, any food, or anything. Anything they get, their wives or children have to bring in. And many of them are in there because they didn't have any food to begin with, and they were stealing a chicken to take it to their family. So now how is their family going to bring in any food to them? And they grovel for any little piece of anything that is dropped. And there's, of course, no deodorant. And they've been in years in the same set of clothing. And you're just like, I've never smelled anything so rank in all my life. Oh, God, help me as I just keep preaching away. And the debauchery and the hopelessness on the faces. And I was standing there, but oh, it wasn't like that at the end. It wasn't like that as they stepped out of that and into the life of the Son of God. But as I stood there, I thought about, I can't imagine what just the smells of hell will be, let alone the worst torment. Because that was just enough to make me where I couldn't do this for a whole day. A place of utter despair. Hell will be much worse than the worst place you can imagine. In fact, that Burundi prison would be a beautiful heaven compared to what hell is going to be. No light, no relief. You can't ever think someday after several billion, trillion, zillion years I might get out. No, that'll still just be the beginning. Jesus talked about it so much more than people do in pulpits today. He didn't see bringing up its description and its torment, because he talks about that, as a lack of compassion. He didn't think it was politically incorrect to bring up the torture you're going to burn where the worm dieth not. He didn't think, oh man, that's way too graphic for a person to understand or comprehend. You know why? He knew it was essential as a good shepherd, motivated by love out of a heart of compassion. Are we doing our best service by not mentioning from pulpits, or not mentioning when we ever talk to anybody, not ever mentioning it to family? Is that true love? I was reading, or maybe listening to a tape, I don't know, that John Bevere tells a story about his friend who went to hell. His heart stopped. He was in ICU, and they're trying to bring him back, which they eventually did. But John had witnessed to him so many times. He rejected him. He cussed at him, leave me alone with this. But he calls him up screaming. He says, I started to descend into it. All of my senses were intact. The darkness was so deep, I couldn't see my hand in front of my face. The fear was so great. He said, I can't describe it in words. The flickering lights of hell, I could see what seemed to be, even though I knew I was still so far away, but I was going at lightning speed towards those flickering lights. He said, I could hear the screams of torment. Creatures with scales, more hideous than anything in any horror movie. He said, started in those guttural voices screaming out, come to me, you're mine. And then they brought him back. And he was ripe to pray and repent.
Oh, yeah.
and come to know Jesus. I've known people, we were talking about on the way here, I'm not going to take time tonight and go into everybody else's testimony. All you got to do is read some books, even from way back when, of atheists who died screaming, oh, there is a hell and I'm going into it and it's too late for me. I've seen the faces of people in Nome, Alaska, because the pastor's job there in some of those village towns, they don't have mortuaries, they don't have funeral parlors. The pastors are stuck. When somebody they know in town, a relative or a friend, commits suicide, he's stuck going, and he sat and told me the stories. And then one day I was with one of them, and he talks about how they put him in these freezers and these body bags. And he said, Debbie, he said, one time I went, and he said, it's somebody that I've preached to, and he kept rejecting salvation, and he kept rejecting salvation. I think his mother was in his church. And he said, I went because they wanted him to identify the body, and he's the one who has to dig in that frozen tundra and try to dig the grave and all of that. And he said, I went and unzipped that bag. And he said, there was a hideous snicker on his face in place. That's the way he died. He said he looked like the devil himself with this mocking sneer on his face. These things are very real. And even if you're right with God tonight, I want this to burn in our hearts that everybody we see, everybody we know is headed there or heaven. It's not a playing games thing. Jesus said in Matthew 10:28, fear not them which kill the body but are not able to kill the soul, but rather fear him which is able to destroy both soul and body in hell. Matthew 5:29-30, if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. He says in Matthew 23:33, ye serpents, ye generation of vipers. Well, that's not too politically correct to begin with. How can you escape the damnation of hell? It's a real place. It's not figurative. We've had many more scriptures, but I've been deleting them and deleting them tonight, or we would be here all night. Hell, a real place. Several names: Hades, the grave, Sheol. We could talk about the Old Testament names, the New Testament names, but I've got other things to get into tonight. Gehenna, the lake of fire, some temporal, others eternal. But in Numbers 16, we see three families physically swallowed up into Sheol. In Revelation 19:20, then the beast was captured, and with him the false prophet, who worked signs in his presence, by which he deceived those who received the mark of the beast and those who worshipped his image. These two were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. We're talking about the Antichrist, the false prophet. They are hurled there with physical bodies and souls. Then we have, of course, Luke 16:19-31. You might want to turn there because in a minute we're going to read it. Lazarus and the rich man. I know many of you are thinking, are you kidding me? Is this Friday night? We know this story. Again, hang on. Not a parable, but specific names. It's talking about Abraham's bosom, the holding area for the Old Testament saints until Jesus made a way for them. And in Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 19, there was a certain rich man, not a parable, there was a certain one, which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate, full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment. Everybody say torment. And seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. And Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. The Bible is what brings conviction, not somebody's experience. If it agrees with the Bible, it can confirm that. But the Word of God is what brings conviction. The Word of God is what changes us. The Word of God shows us the truth and the way. So we see here the rich man was in great pain. Another translation says agony, anguish, torment. The suffering is very great, conscious torment. We can see that he recognized Abraham and Lazarus, and they recognized him. Do you realize that we're going to have some still really very human, recognizable, some kind of flesh in hell? Not we, I'm not going to be there, but people are. He had his reason, he had his faculties, he had his emotion, he had his will. He had physical features where he could be recognized and where he had senses. He could see, he could hear, he could feel pain. So some sort of flesh. He desired to have his tongue cooled. And yet that flesh is continuously afflicted and marred by fire and worms. We've heard people say that have seen hell or even had a vision of it. Many of them have said that the flesh is scraped away by claws and by things. And then it comes right back on immediately, and that happens again. Wow, you can't have companionship there. One of the greatest torments would be eternal remembrance. He remembered what he should have known up there. I remember Lazarus. In fact, I know something about Abraham. I remember I rejected the truth. I remembered I didn't do right. I remembered that Debbie was preaching on that Friday night. I remembered I had a pastor who was always trying to see me delivered and out of sin and victorious. I remember all that. Why didn't I listen? You don't even want companionship down there because you don't want anyone to be there. We went to a funeral a couple years ago in supposed to be sort of a church that knows the Word of God. And all this guy who never knew Jesus had died of an overdose, all of his pals are there. And they're rowdy. I've never seen that at a funeral. They're rowdy and they're shouting, oh man, it's party time. And they're saying, hey bro, we'll be there with you soon and we'll have a six pack with you. We'll all party together. And you know, the preacher got up and preached him right into heaven, even though that's not where he was at. And all the people are like, yeah, cool, we're all going to party, we're all going to booze it up there together. Up there, in neither place will there be any booze. And nobody would want their friends partying with them in hell. They're like, oh, if I could go back and get my buddies to not be here with me. He pleaded for his brothers in this story. Abraham told him, no. If they won't believe the prophets, they're not going to believe you anyway. That's a powerful truth. No experience can persuade people greater than the Word, the living Word of the Lord Jesus Christ, the living Word of God. Many, many will hear an experience and it'll produce enough belief to follow God for about a week. Have you seen that? Because they never heard repent. They never heard commit. They never heard make Him Lord. Okay, Jesus, I guess you're real. While they're chewing on their gum, their baseball cap sideways. Yeah, am I in now, the born again club? And it lasts a week or two, no heart change. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. That's what produces the difference. 1 Peter 1:23, having been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. So important we teach and preach the word of God, not just our experience. In Luke 16, the rich man and Lazarus, there was no crossing over from where he was to where he was. Just a moment after your death, your eternity is sealed. No, I changed my mind, Pastor Mark. I was almost there. Come on, help me get in here. No one can bring you from heaven to hell or from hell to heaven. No one can pray or buy you out. There is no purgatory. The Bible says once you die, your eternity is sealed. Your opportunity to make a decision is right now. Jesus was the friend of sinners, but he was always telling them, There is a way. Forsake that sin. Come to me. Someone who once knew the Lord and is now backslidden is still on their way to hell.
True.
I'm going to be saying that more in just a few minutes. A person who had a right and living relationship with God and then basically said, so what? I'm letting go of it. I'm letting go of him. I'm letting go of his word. I'm letting go of his conviction. I'm letting go of his Holy Spirit. I'm letting go of all of it, and I'm going my own way. They are on their way to hell.
Amen.
A backslidden believer, there is no such thing. But for the sake of what people call it, hang on. A backslidden believer is a believer who is not living in victory over sin, but sin is living in victory over him. He's not even a believer anymore. Revelation 20, 13 through 15, the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Revelation 21, 8, but the cowardly, unbelieving, abominable, murderers, sexually immoral, unless they said a prayer. Is that what it says? No, it doesn't say that. Sexually immoral, which the church is rampant with.
Right.
Sorcerers, idolaters, even if it's the pigskin football.
Right.
And all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. The lake that burns with fire. And in some translations, you see sulfur. You know what sulfur is? A non-metallic substance that burns with great heat and produces a very unpleasant smell. Many have talked about smelling that. In fact, that man, that friend of John Bevere, said the stench was so unbearable, not to mention people's flesh burning up. And no possible way to describe the torment and horror to the senses. Not some, I've heard people who are supposed to be charismatic. I mean, they can preach on other subjects and you would think it's dynamic. And they have told me, I just think it has something to do with cleansing now. What? You never heard people talking like this till lately. Cleansing? This doesn't sound like cleansing to me. Now listen, the term the second death in Revelation 2:11, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. I wouldn't think the churches would need this, would you? He who overcomes shall not be hurt by the second death. He's talking to the churches, not people who said they never believed. And I find that very interesting. I want you to hear, and I wish I had time to go back because I have this in another message where I have scripture all over the place here. Three main categories of people who will burn in the lake of fire. Number one, those who have turned their back on him. Many scriptures about that.
Right.
Number two, those who were unfaithful to him. Many scriptures on that. Three, those sinners who never accepted him. But if you hear of any today, that's the only one you usually hear of.
Right.
But the first two are in the church. In the church. And yet forever and ever with no relief coming. Revelation 20:10. The devil who deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Jesus said this about everybody who doesn't obey his word. Matthew 25, 46, and these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Revelation 14, 10 and 11. I'm going to skip a few here, but I'm going to go to this. It's talking about you must drink the wine of God's anger. It has been poured full strength into God's cup of wrath. And they will be tormented with fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. The smoke of their torment will rise forever and ever, and they will have no relief day or night, for they have worshipped the beast and his statue and have accepted the mark of his name. Forever and ever. Try to comprehend that. We can't with our head, only with our hearts. You know, wow. I'm just asking the Holy Ghost to help me get this out. There's so much that I feel the necessity of getting across tonight. I know what I just said about experience, but I believe the Word of God backs this up. I had something happen one day because especially for so many years, I taught so much on the subject of stewardship with Pastor Rodney and with others. And one day when I was home, I said, Lord, why is it that born-again, spirit-filled Christians who love you have a hard time even tithing, that your Old Testament servants, they weren't even your kids, they weren't even born again, they didn't have this kind of joy we do, they weren't baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Why would New Testament covenant people struggle with what they didn't even struggle with? And I will never forget the answer as long as I live. And before I tell you what the answer is, I'm going to tell you that I had a pastor in, I'm going to go ahead and say where, a different pastor in Norway. I've only been there the one time on that one Sunday, and unless he repents, I never will be again. But he came to some other meetings I was at. He's like, I'm loving this, and I'm loving your teaching and stewardship. Our church just won't give, and would you come? I had to get on a ferry. We had to get up at what, like 5 o'clock in the morning, go on a ferry to go across to this place for one Sunday morning. And he says, when we get there, you know, I'll give you 10% of whatever comes in. I wanted to say, I got to walk out the door right now. But what I did say, no, I don't want anything. I'm going to bless you with it. This isn't about, hey, if a lot comes in, I'll give you, brother. And I said, I just came at my own expense, getting up early in the morning. I want to see your church set free and get some. So I'm preaching away. He's my translator. And it's going pretty well. And all of a sudden, I start telling what I'm about to tell you, and the air is sucked out of the room. And I can feel that he's not translating. And I had Norwegian friends in the audience, and they told me later that he said, disregard everything she just said. It's false. It's heresy. Just take the rest of it. I was wondering why everybody just sat there. Then he tells me afterwards he has a record tithe and offering. Now let me give you 10. No. And I just shook the dust off my feet as I left. But here's what I told them. That when I asked the Lord that, he said, what makes you think they're believers? I was so shocked. I said, God, we aren't talking about that. Maybe you misunderstood what I'm asking you, Lord. I'm asking you about believers, spirit-filled believers in the church. I heard again, what makes you think they're believers? Well, Lord, you can't equate tithing with, you know, if you call upon the name of the Lord, you'll be saved. And if you confess your sin, he's faithful and just to forgive you. And you, Lord, I'm so confused here. And then this is what I saw. It was another one of those times I got a very quick, kind of a little mini vision, very fast. I could see people going into heaven or thinking they're going into heaven. And the Lord says, what makes you think that you're coming in here? Oh, look, my name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. I know that's what it takes. You just check that book. I'm in there. What makes you think your name is in here? This is what I heard. Because I remember the day and hour I called in your name, asked you to forgive me my sin. So you believe my word. You believe Romans 10, 9 and 10, huh? Yeah, I believe your word. And then this is what I heard. Did you believe my word in Malachi 3 that I don't open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing where there isn't room enough to receive it? Well, I didn't really believe Malachi 3 because that's Old Testament, but I believe Romans 10, 9 and 10. Oh, really? Do you believe Luke where it says, as you give, it'll be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over? Well, I didn't really believe that, but I believe Romans 10, 9 and 10. You didn't believe 2 Corinthians 9 and the scripture? Well, I didn't exactly believe that, but I believe Romans 10, 9 and 10. So you didn't, and I mean every scripture that I knew and some I didn't know about giving. I'm seeing the Lord ask them, did you not believe this book, this chapter? So you can believe me for your eternal security, something you can't feel or see or smell, but you can't believe me for 10 cents off a dollar that you can hold in your hand and you can touch. You say you believe me, but you never believed me.
Right.
And I was just like,
that's right. It's
I've never heard anybody else say it, but I've never forgotten it. What do we believe? What we want to believe? The parts we want to believe? Okay, I know this isn't last night in the joy rolling. We've got to be soul winners, folks.
Yeah.
because people are headed to one place or another. I got a whole lot more on hell, but I'm going to leave it right there. It's a real place, and we want to make sure that we don't go there. We want to make sure everybody we know, nobody goes there. Anybody we meet doesn't go there. We have got it. It's heaven and hell have to become so real to us where eternity becomes everything we're thinking about. Every plan we make, every moment that we're breathing and that we're dreaming, it's all about eternity and souls. Now, for those of you sitting here thinking, well, I'm not quite sure what that about hell was all about because I'm fine. I'm in the church. I'm spirit-filled. I am a tither. Or whatever else you might be saying. We cannot excuse sin, especially when somebody says that they've been born again. We can't excuse sin in our own lives, in each other's lives. 1 John 1:7, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us. If he cleansed me from it, how can I still have it? And why should I still have it? 1 John 3:6, whosoever abides in him sinneth not, except on Wednesdays and late night Fridays. And sometimes because we're all human, and much of the time because we're all human and he understands. If I hear one more time, well, I know I'm not obeying his word exactly, at least the way you see it, Debbie, but he knows my heart exactly. Exactly, he does. I don't know how this thing became so wise. We know somebody who says, you know, I'm not like you guys. I don't know any Bible verses or anything, but I know what I feel in my heart. And their doctrine is based on that. If he isn't the one guiding the reins of our heart is wicked. 1 John 3:9, whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. I cannot help it but sin. Oh, that is the total opposite of what I'm reading. But I just can't help it. I'm trying so hard, Pastor, but I can't help it. He says you can't sin. Oh, wow. I can't stay in each one of these very long. But 1 John 5:18, we know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. But how many know I'm still reading Scripture and a lot of it and had to take a lot out because we don't have time? But he that is begotten of God keepeth himself. Oh, we can do that?
Yeah.
And that wicked one toucheth him not.
The devil's been after me all week. Bless his holy name.
People do say that. They don't even remember if they're talking about the Lord or the enemy.
Right.
No, he can't even touch us. 2 Peter 2:4-6. For if God spared not the angels that sin, I would think they would get a little break, wouldn't you? But cast them down to hell. Whoa, I guess no break. And delivered them unto chains of darkness to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly. We're supposed to be learning from these examples, the Bible keeps telling us.
Right.
19-22, while they promised them liberty, that's what's going on out here today, they themselves are the servants of corruption. For of whom a man is overcome, of the same is he brought in bondage. For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the... Wait a minute, I'm going to look at this again. They've already escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus. They got saved.
Absolutely.
They are again entangled... But now they get a free ride because they said the prayer. Oh, I think I better look again. They are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have ever known the way of righteousness, than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned into his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. Oh, boy, that sounds rather judgmental. It even sounds like name-calling. 2 Corinthians 12:21. At last when I come, my God will humble me among you, the Apostle Paul is saying, by the Holy Ghost, and that I shall be well many which have sinned already and have not repented of the uncleanness and fornication and lasciviousness which they have committed. The Apostle Paul goes, come on, church, why are you letting this stuff go on? Well, I'm grieving over these born-again, spirit-filled people who are in sin again. We're talking about holiness. Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Ephesians 1:4, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Ephesians 5:27, that he might present it to himself a glorious church. That's what we've started out talking about this week. And what does he say a glorious church is? One shaken enough, one laughing enough. I'm gonna check this out. Not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Colossians 1:22, in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. But as he, 1 Peter 1:15, but as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. 1 Peter 1:16, because it is written, be ye holy for I am holy, and we could go on and on and on. But why there is such confusion out there is because of the great deception that is taking place in this hour. And even though you need to thank God every day and every night and pray for your pastors, pray for all your leaders, and I'm sure you're doing it. I want to just see you continue in it. Because this, I've said it all week, this is so unusual to have a pure flow of the river coming from the throne room of God where you can grow in all areas of God. It is almost getting unheard of in this nation and so many nations because of deception. If we're going to walk in the things we've been talking about all week, come on, let's take the land. Come on, let's move in signs and wonders. We are going to have to realize that deception is taking place and we can't touch it. And we've got to recognize it immediately. I told your pastor today that many years ago in Alaska, can you bear with me if I go a little longer tonight? Because God's laid this heavily on my heart. Okay, good, 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 good. Years ago in the state of Alaska, I'm in a church where I've been many times. The pastors are some of my dearest friends. A man in the church who sat in that church for a long time brought a book to me. He said, oh, Miss Debbie, you gotta read this book. It's so awesome. It's the best book I've ever read. And I looked at the author, never heard of the man. This is many years ago. And I'm like, okay, looks good. And all right, thank you. I'll take it back to my hotel and read it. And I had a great man of God who taught me a long time ago that even if there's some things you can't agree with, many times you can eat the hay and spit out the sticks, especially if you're fairly mature. So that's what I'm expecting to do, or maybe there won't even be any sticks in it. No preconceived idea. I started reading it. I'm in the first chapter, and the Holy Ghost was all over me. I was trembling. I was beginning to weep. He said, this is the greatest deception coming to the body of Christ in this hour. And I went... And I never read the rest of it, handed it back to him. I told him what the Lord said to me. He looked at me like I had lost my ever-living mind. And I said, I'm sorry. It was several years before I started to hear this man's name again, and then all the time. Right. Because he's on television, he writes lots of books, he's nice looking, he's charismatic in personality, and he's got a lot of good teaching, right. It looks like and sounds like. But by now, I knew what deception was sandwiched. Another great man of God told us a long time ago, he said, if you're going to poison an animal, you don't just lay poison on the plate. You put it inside a good piece of meat. Not that anybody wants to think about that, but that's exactly what has happened. So now I'm on a local, very, very limited, it's just in our county, but a local television station every week. Almost never get to see it. We're too busy. But one night we were home and said, oh, just remember, this is the night I'm on TV. We should watch it and see what they're playing right now. We turned it on a little bit early. Unbeknown to me, this very famous man was being piped through TBN into their station before me. And I'm like, you got to be kidding. He's on before me. I'm going to sit down and I'm going to listen to this. He was preaching about faith and healing. And I sat there going, I couldn't have said it better myself. It was awesome. It's what I believe in all of that. What I believe right now. In fact, I figured people probably listen to him, and then they listen to me when I talk about healing and faith and go, oh, yeah, you can tell these guys are all the same. That.
Right.
And I went, Lord, he's right on about faith. He's right on about healing. And he is so far off about sin and grace that people are sliding into hell rapidly because of it. Now I go back to Norway, I go to Sweden, I go to many other countries where they say, I told you this the other night, this church shut down because this grace message came in over here. Now everybody's sleeping together, everybody's drinking alcohol, everybody's doing this and this and that. This church was a mighty church. In fact, I got saved there. It's shut down now because that grace message. And I'm just like, dear God, dear God. Then I start hearing about people. I graduated from one of the Bible schools I went to with all getting into this. I've heard some of them teach. And I'm like, dear God. Sometimes you can feel a little bit lonely out there. But then I think Jeremiah did and Isaiah did. And I think anybody who was, and I'm not saying I'm a prophet, not at all, but I'm just using them as an example. Any true prophet of the Lamb is lonely out there proclaiming righteousness. And in this hour, in the United States of America, and in this hour, in the nations of the world, if you're going to proclaim holiness and righteousness, it's going to be a little bit lonely until we proclaim it enough that people get delivered. And we got to just dig our heels in. And we got to say, God, I will stand for you, and I will say what you say, and I will do what you say do. Hallelujah. Yes, it has to be. Matthew 24:11, many false prophets shall rise and shall deceive many. 2 Thessalonians 2:3, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. We already got that Antichrist spirit in the world, and we're rapidly going in that direction. 2 Thessalonians 2:10-12, and with all deceitfulness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because they receive not the love of truth, that they might be. Anytime somebody goes over the top of conviction, God wants me to make, what if I would have done that today when Pastor Mark was teaching? You know what? I can see he's given scripture. Yeah, that's probably right. But my camp says, and great men of God said, and I've taught it this way, and I would probably have to stand up and tell somebody I was wrong. Phew, that'd be tough. Besides that, he's one man. Maybe he could be wrong.
Right.
And he could be, but that's not. But people usually use that in with their excuses of, so what? He's a man, I'm a man, we're both saved. Put our pants and dresses on the same way. Not both of us doing both of those things. People come up with all kinds of stuff to justify. And it's so simple to say, I was wrong. Forgive me. Thank you for clarity. Thank you for revelation. Thank you that you love me enough. Thank you that you care for me enough. Thank you for the blood enough. Thank you for the Holy Ghost enough. Thank you, Lord, that I still can hear you. Thank you that I can turn, even if it isn't sin. Even if it's that I got something a little askew or a lot askew. I can just turn so quickly and get into that blood. And that you talk about grace. That's grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says in verse 12, they all might be damned who believe not the truth, but have pleasure in unrighteousness. It's part of the signs of the last days, 2 Timothy 3:2-5. This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but not denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Us revival people love to use that word, verse 5. You know, the religious crowd, they don't have the joy. They don't know. And that's true too. But look at the context of this. That's pretty interesting. Yeah. The context of this is people that want to live in sin have a form of godliness denying the power thereof. It's so important to preach repentance. Repentance goes beyond feeling. To express a distinct purpose of turning from sin to righteousness. Not just, oh, I'm crying, I did some bad things. I have a distinct purpose, God, to turn away from that and to turn to you and to let you and your glory and your spirit and your truth and your holiness and your word overcome me, where I just walk away from that, turn away from that. A distinct purpose. The Bible word most often translate, anytime you start getting into Greek and Hebrew, I'm fine anywhere else. They don't know either. But I'm like, oh God, let this be the right Greek word, the right Hebrew word. I'm just kidding. But when you've got a Greek and Hebrew scholar before you, but as near as I can see, the Bible word most often translated repentance means a change of mental and spiritual attitude towards sin. Repentance is a change that takes place in one's life as a result of the Holy Spirit's work. It illuminates our consciousness to the state of sin and the presence of a holy God. And one of the words for repentance, I'm not even going to get into trying to pronounce these, especially here. But it means to lament, to grieve. This word is describing the emotions that are aroused when motivated to take a different course of action. And there should be some emotion with it because we're a three-part being and we have emotions. But also it expresses, another word that's used for repentance, expresses a radical change of mind towards sin and implies a conscious moral separation from sin and a decision to forsake it and agree with God. Yeah. And in the New Covenant, there are another couple of words. That was in the Hebrew. In the New Covenant, in the Greek, a couple of words, again, to have feeling or care, concern or regret, which is akin to remorse. And it means to have another mind, which describes that radical change when a sinner turns from the idols of sin and self to a holy God. Repentance, then, is informing and the changing of the mind. It's stirring and directing the emotions to urge the required change. It's the action of the yielded will and turning away from sin and to God. It's not you're just sorry that you got caught at something, like a man who's cheated on his wife and oops, sorry, never again. He's not sorry. I'm not talking about a man who truly has been in adultery and repented before his wife, but especially before God, and turned and changed. That's the most awesome thing. I've seen people who've had better honeymoons than they did in the first place when God's work is in place. But I'm talking about the man who never repents, never turns, and just, oops, got caught. Sorry. That's what people do with God all the time.
Right.
All the time. We've got to preach the message of repentance out of our love for Christ and love for his people. Not out of fear for the scorners do we hold back and say, oh, this isn't popular anymore. People are determined to protect their sin, and we must get comfortable with making intelligent judgments on moral issues. Because if we don't make them, God will hold our nation, he'll hold the church, first of all, responsible, but he's going to hold this nation responsible for what we allow. You've heard it over and over and over again. The mess that the nation is in, it doesn't lie at the feet of the politicians. It lies at the feet of the church that haven't proclaimed, haven't turned from sin, haven't witnessed to people, haven't cared, haven't been compassionate, haven't taken a moral stand, haven't preached the truth. Acts 2:38, just in case you think repentance due to a lot of popular books is not in the Bible. Acts 2:38, Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Is this Bible?
Yes.
Is this New Testament?
Yes.
Is this after the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Yes. Acts 3:19, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Acts 17:30, and the times of this ignorance God winked at, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. God commands it and authors are refuting it.
Right.
I'm going to go with him. Acts 20:21, testifying both to the Jews and to the Greeks, repentance toward God and faith toward our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 2:4, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads thee to repentance. Even as in his goodness, we were singing tonight about his grace. Every time we sing about what he's done for us, doesn't it make you want to go, oh God, the God who did this for me, the God who's blessed me, the God who's healed me, the God who saved me, the God who's touched me, the God who bubbles up within me, the God who's called me, the God who keeps me, the God who strengthens me. I don't want anything to do with that rotten sin that would bind me. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 12:21. Lest when I come again, my God. Oh, I already read that. We're going to let it go. I got a lot of these two or three times. We're going to talk about a little bit being separate from the world. I grew up hearing that. I grew up in Pentecost. We are to be separated. We are a peculiar people, a peculiar generation. Don't be worldly. But then came the age of enlightenment in the church. They were all legalistic. They all had more don'ts than they had do's. Some of that could have been true from place to place. But I'm telling you, I was taught about the blood, and I was taught that he was holy. And I had parents that didn't know the Lord. And I can remember, they said, honey, you got to go to your prom. This is so stupid not to go to your prom. I said, I wouldn't even think of being there with that rock and roll music and with dancing with some guy I have no relationship with and getting up close and doing those weird movements and wearing these clothes with the top down to here or a skirt up to here. And mom and dad are like, you're just getting to be a religious nut. I didn't have parents who said you can't go, but I'm telling you, I have been taught that he is holy. And because of his righteousness, I am righteous. And I am holy because of his blood, because of his sacrifice, and that I have the Holy Ghost on the inside of me. And my body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And I had no desire for any of that. I'm going to tell you some things. Some of the old time great preachers that saw so many thousands come to Jesus, some of the stands they took. Charles Spurgeon, I'm going to read a few of his quotes. We shall not adjust our Bible to the age, but before we are done with it, by God's grace, we shall adjust the age to the Bible. Yeah. If Christ has died for me, I cannot trifle with the evil that killed my best friend. He who does not hate the false does not love the true. And he to whom it is all the same, whether it be God's word or man's, is himself unrenewed at heart. True. Well, I know, Debbie, you said the Bible says this, but so-and-so, the great famous author who's on TV, said this. His word is not God's word. There should be as much difference between the worldling. Obviously, they talked a little bit different between the person who's unregenerated, unsaved, not born again. There should be as much difference between the worldling and the Christian as between hell and heaven. True. Between destruction and eternal life. True. Boy, you can't see much difference a lot of times these days. When there is something in the Bible that churches don't like, they call it legalism, Leonard Ravenhill said. Yeah, anything. Anything they don't like. Legalism, legalism, legalism. I mean, I can't sleep with anybody. I can't get drunk. I can't do drugs. I can't hate. I can't cuss. I can't swear. I can't curse. I can't. No. Legalism. And the siren starts going. Somebody who's all legalistic is here. No, somebody who believes the Bible is here. J.D. Shuttlesworth, what is popular is seldom never right, and what is right is seldom ever popular. One of the youth leaders at the River wrote this, and I thought it was so good. The generation not changed by this world is the generation that will change the world. Right. If you won't let the world change you, you will change it. Hallelujah. Our society, much of the church is a mess. An overwhelming increase in permissiveness, leaders falling to sin, moral actions unthinkable 30 or 40 years ago are now commonplace. Dishonesty, shading the truth. I had to write somebody in one of these countries a letter a few years ago. I didn't want to do it, but every time I tried to talk to him, every time my husband tried to talk to him, he just said, I'm not talking about these things. And I kept going, God, I got to meet him here. I got to meet him in mercy. I got to meet him in grace. And I love the man, and I love... But finally, the Lord said, write him a letter. He won't listen to you on the phone. He'll hang up. He won't. Write him a letter that you cannot. It costs me finances, open doors where people were seeing me all over the world. Some of the who's who in the charismatic zoo. But oh, where Jesus was concerned, I felt this. And I begged him to turn from some things. I saw him a while back in a place. It was so funny. They set him right beside me in a certain place. And, of course, nobody there knew about all this. I'm like, oh, great. First time I've seen him since this letter. I got asked to teach that day. I sat back down. He's crying. I'm crying. I mean, everybody was weeping. The glory was just in the house. And when you're like that, you don't want anything between you and anybody. And I knew I was taking a chance when I said this. And my husband told me, maybe you shouldn't have said that. But I leaned over and I said, so-and-so, you know I never meant to hurt you with that letter. I love you. And he goes, it's okay. He kind of straightened up his tears. It's okay, I forgive you. Not, please ask me to forgive you for all the things I've done, or I'm turning, I'm making adjustments, nothing. And then he said afterwards, since you've said that, you can come back sometime if you want. And I thought, I can't come back. Nothing's changed. But that had nothing to do with my love for him and my wanting him to come in all the way. But we've got to take some stands. Nobody wants to in the church. Where am I going to preach? What am I going to do?
Right.
I'm going to live for Jesus. That's what I'm going to do. And I'm going to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. We've watered so much down and compromised the word to suit our own ends. Pastors, drunk driving, it's on the news, it's everywhere, leaving their wives. But in tolerance, we're trying to accommodate everyone. I'm going to make this plain, and I'm sure most of you already know this, but I'm going to say this very plain. We are definitely not saved by works, but by His grace, thank God, we can work for 10 billion years and earn a minute of our salvation. But we are saved unto works. And if we don't have any, we never got saved. James 2, 22 through 26, and the scripture was fulfilled, which saith, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called the friend of God. You see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only. Is this still the Bible?
Yeah.
Likewise also was not Rahab, the harlot, justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Yeah. I've been hearing preachers who used to know better say James should not have been canonized and in the Bible. Talk about changing the word for your own lifestyle. Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship, created in Jesus Christ unto good works. Oh, maybe Ephesians shouldn't have been canonized either.
Right.
Which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Oh, I see another one that shouldn't have been canonized. 2 Timothy 3:17, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. And I found another one and had to take out a bunch because I didn't have room. Titus 2:14, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Titus 3:8, this is a faithful saying, and these things I will that thou affirm constantly, that they which have believed in God might be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable unto man. But you say, here we go, you must be tolerant, Debbie. I mean, that's all we're hearing in politics, even though nobody's tolerant of each other. But we keep hearing that mantra everywhere. What is tolerance? I looked it up in the dictionary. It says a fair, objective, and permissive attitude toward opinions and practices that differ from one's own. Permissive. Now, if we're talking about my opinions and your opinions, that would be good. I will be permissive to yours. You be permissive to mine. But we aren't talking about yours and mine. We're talking about the holy word of God. That we can't say, God, you've got to be permissive toward my thoughts. I mean, I know my heart. My heart says something different than what your word says. No, that is the final authority, the only authority. The only authority. Is it about our viewpoint? No, the Bible's. We've got to hold firm to what the Bible says. Tolerance has become the most misused and abused word in the English language. Now, obviously, I'm picking up some things that I've studied and read places, but you listen to this carefully. We will not situationally redefine or conditionally apply his word to suit political correctness, cultural tolerances, modern ethics, and false religions, or even to avoid invading the comfort zones of Christians. Jesus spent 3 days in hell and down there conquering, making a spoil of them openly. He did that so that we don't even have to spend one moment in hell. Why should we water any of that down? For too long, well-meaning clergy have fed people with watered-down scriptures to avoid invading that comfort zone. You and I, and I know your pastors, thank God, won't do that. And anyone watching online, we have made a commitment. We are not going to do that. If they take us off, if YouTube goes down, if whatever laws are instituted, we will not compromise. We are the church, the blood-bought church of the Lord Jesus Christ. We love people too much to feed them lies. We won't pull people away from Christ, which is what that doctrine does. If you're going to practice the faith and what is expected of it, you have to be very intolerant of sin. Let me say that again. You've got to be very intolerant of sin, even and especially our own. I won't tolerate this. I can't believe you even thought that. I won't tolerate this. Right. I won't tolerate what you just started watching TV. No, you're not flesh. No, you aren't. I won't tolerate this in me. We embrace the sinner, but not the sin. You know, a charismatic, supposedly spirit-filled person that I love very much, love their personality, love a lot of things about them. Got to be somewhat careful here. Great talent, great. But I started noticing their Facebook posts. Boy, I can tell you, you can see right into hearts on Facebook. Everything was, you know, when the lights went up at the White House, come on, Christians, don't say anything about that. You know, let everybody be alone. And I start looking at the church they're going to that I understand tolerates homosexuality. And then pretty soon, if anybody said anything and took a moral stand on anything, oh, Christians don't do that. And by the time it wasn't me writing stuff, it was other people. But I thought, by the time you're done reading that, yeah, we should never say anything politically. We should and I'm not talking about making that our focus, but there is a time to say this judgment by the Supreme Court was wrong. Our final authority is the Bible. Right. But I noticed everything this person was putting on there was just the opposite. And I felt that the Lord kept talking to me about helping to guide them and give them other chances. But I saw some things recently and I just grieved and went, oh God, I love this man. But one of the last things I saw him say a while back was, I hate it when Christians say they love the sinner but not the sin. I thought, why do you hate that? That's what we all got to do. Unless in your case it's both. Unless in your case it's sinner and sin. Anyway, we've got to help the sinner out of bondage. I had some stuff in here about restoration that was beautiful and wonderful, but I realized I didn't have time for it tonight. There are other sides of all of these mountains when somebody really truly repents, and how gracious and how loving we need to be to restore them. But I don't have time to go there tonight. We embrace the sinner, but not the sin. We help the sinner out of bondage by loving him enough to tell him the truth. Jesus will send the unforgiven into the fiery pits of hell and not excuse any sin. He will forgive us all our sins if we will ask, if we will repent, but he will not excuse any sin. I'm getting ahead of myself, but in case I don't have time to get there, do you realize every sin that was sin before our salvation experience is still sin after our salvation experience? It's funny how that suddenly becomes okay. But what grieved the heart of God before we got saved still grieves the heart of God after we get saved. I heard a pastor in Washington before we started our church, and after my husband resigned his, we're looking, we're going an hour, we're going 2 hours to try to find any church that preaches the truth. And I thought, well, I like the worship here, and they preach some faith things, and they seem to have a little bit of the move of the Spirit. Maybe we can park here. And I heard him say, you know, God was angry about sin in the Old Testament, but he's not angry at all anymore. And I thought, man, I got to take a bunch of verses out about his wrath, especially some of those we read in Revelation, his wrath being poured out. Guess he changed his mind, got angry again. he is the Lord God who changeth not. It's Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. He hates sin like he always hated sin. If it grieved him before we came to Jesus and we do it again, it still grieves him. We're living in a day when the Word of God is under attack as never before. As the errant church tries to straddle the fence between righteousness and the evil of political correctness. It's distancing us from our Christian roots. That's why I like to get some of those old timers out. This is where the church was, and this is where they were preaching. A new emphasis on tolerance that wants to redefine America, wants to redefine the church, wants to redefine the Bible, all of it. No, I've never, when I've been preaching before, quoted Phil Robertson of Duck Dynasty. But in this particular instance, he said, our culture has accepted two huge lies. The first is that if you disagree with someone's lifestyle, you must fear or hate them. Anybody ever heard that out there? The second is that to love someone means you agree with everything they believe or do. Both are nonsense. You don't have to compromise convictions to be compassionate. Billy Sunday said a revival does two things, that powerful preacher. It does two things. First, it returns the church from her backsliding. And second, it causes the conversion of men and women. And it always includes the conviction of sin on the part of the church. What a spell the devil seems to cast over the church today. And that was a long time ago, folks. Yeah. Revival, I think anybody who's been around me a little while from the other times I've been here, you know I love the manifestations of the Holy Ghost. Yeah. You know I love joy. You know I love fire. You know I love the river flowing. You know I love dancing. I love shouting. I love crying. I love laughing. I love whatever, whichever way he wants to move upon us. But that wasn't revival. That was when we're touched in a profound way, how we may react and how, but revival is supposed to do what just today, like back then, those things. Yeah. Bring sinners to Christ. Yeah. It's supposed to cause people to come out of their backslidden state and go 110% for Jesus. Yeah. With no compromise. We've got to be changed so we can change the world. Yeah. You could go to the best place that has the most manifestations in the entire world and study that and think you're flowing with it if you don't get the word deep in you and you don't forsake sin and you don't have victory over sin and you don't listen to the Holy Ghost and you don't turn when he says turn and stop when he says stop and run when he says run and you aren't willing and obedient, you will never have revival. You will get in heresy, you will get in flakiness, and then you will end up in doctrines of devils. We've got to be changed to change the world. What's happening in America is not separate from what's happening in the church. We should have been the light. We should have been the salt. And it could have never got so rotten. Salt is a preservative. Stuff can't get rotten when there's a lot of salt. God's calling and his shaking is coming to this country and the world. And without the shaking, the nation probably won't make it back. We're trying to believe. We're trying to pray. We're trying to prophesy. But you look through history. That's usually what it takes. God warns, though, because there's hope. If you'll listen to me, if my people will humble, well, that's hard when I don't ever want to say I'm wrong, will humble themselves. I've been going the wrong way. Oh, God, I've been going the wrong way. Humble themselves and pray. Turn from our wicked way. I said the prayer. I can still have my wicked ways. Then he'll hear from heaven. Then he'll forgive us. Then he'll heal our land. God spoke to Solomon in 2 Chronicles 7:14. That if is the answer to America. Not Wall Street, not the Capitol, not the President, not the White House. Jesus, the Messiah, the light of the world, the hope of our nation will only be in him. The hope of anyone is only in him. It's time for the good to get great. Let's not settle for the good. Let's be great. Let's go, God, I'm in 110% with you. I'm not going to compromise any part of your word. We are the candle that lights up the world. We've got to shine in revival or shine in persecution. I choose to do so right now, but I will do that and that also if and when the day comes. But come on, if we don't do it now, it will come. And we will do it one way or another or completely forsake him. We've got to have warriors again. I'm not talking about goofy people dressing up in army fatigues and physically trying to do battle. I could tell you stuff in Alaska, but I'm not going to glorify the enemy. People climbing mountains, renting airplanes to put oil in the skies. Did nothing. What are you doing? I'm rebuking the devil. I said, did you ever try tithing? I mean, that seems like a lot to put on that stuff and learn to do war dances against the devil and get in airplanes and climb high mountains. Man, Paul and Jesus, I don't even know if they had access to high mountains. I don't know how they ever got the devil down, but I said, my Bible says if I'm just a tither, just try that one. It's got a lot of other things to say, but if I'm a tither, he'll rebuke the devil.
Yes, he will.
No, I'm going to get an army outfit on. Anyway, I'm not talking about those kind of warriors. We're talking about a true prayer warrior that will resist their own flesh and resist the fatigue and resist what the enemy wants to do and intercede and learn to step over there. Is what is in your heart a radical conversion? I wish I could tell you the whole story of my husband's conversion. I liked it, getting to tell it to other people just because I like to hear it over and over and over again. But I'll tell you this little bit. He, even though he had been raised in, with some Christian teaching, there was hypocrisy in the home and all kinds of junk that just shoved him further the other way. And by the time he was really a younger one than this, but especially by the time he was a teenager, total rebel. He goes in the Air Force at a young age. Gets married at 16 to his first wife, and who is in heaven today. Although it was awfully young, it only lasted 54 years. It did last 54 years, and she went to heaven. I knew her, wonderful woman. But so he became a flight engineer in the Air Force. He's traveling all over the world, and he was like, I don't want to hear about God. I don't want. In fact, he bought into evolution. Was teaching people about that evolution is the truth, and as the, and just totally against God and his things, and God began to work on him, and I'm not going to tell you the whole story about how he got his attention in an airplane, but when he did, he's like, oh, God's real, God's real. And he got home and his wife was crying, and he said, what's wrong with you? She goes, I don't know, I'm just miserable. He says, I think I know what's wrong. God's talking to us. And he said, I'm not quite sure how this works. Didn't even have a class on it. He goes, but I kind of feel like maybe we should kneel down. I'm a sinner. I want you, Jesus. In fact, you called your father, didn't you? Who by then had gotten truly saved. Can you help us in this prayer? And can you help? He said, we never discussed this. We never had a class on it. He said, my wife loved to smoke so much that she always said, if I could smoke one 6 feet long, I would. I love it like that. He said, I never said anything to her. She never said anything to me. He was a smoker. He was a drinker. He was a partier. The NCO club. And when they got up off that floor, they never touched another thing. Never touched another, never desired it, never discussed it, never said, should we do this? Should we not do this? That's the kind of conversion you used to hear about, because the Spirit of God comes in and drives out darkness. They never used to say, I said the prayer, I want to keep doing all the stuff I did before in bondage. No. Oh, I could read you a lot of verses about how different we're supposed to be, but I got to keep moving. We're supposed to be the salt and life, light, Matthew 5, 13 through 16, you're the salt of the earth. If the salt hath lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It's thenceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and trodden under foot of men. You're the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick. And it giveth light unto all them that are in the house. Let your light, not your mixture, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. One of the major temptations in the church today is mixing the standards of the world with God's standards. 2 Corinthians 6 answers that. What concord hath Christ with Belial? What part hath he that believeth with an infidel? What agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, come out among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I was going to read the entire chapter of Romans chapter 6 about sin having no place in us. I want you to write it down. I want you to go home and read it. I know your pastor preaches out of it. I know, but I want you to read it more than once. And just let it settle in on you. It lets us know sin has no place in us whatsoever. Ephesians 2, 1 through 13 lets us know you used to be like this.
Right.
But God changes everything. You were going this way. You were mixed up in all this stuff. But God, now you're going this way and have nothing to do with it again. If you proclaim the name of Christ, hallelujah. Ephesians 5, 1 through 20, the same thing. Ephesians 3, 17 through 27. Christians are being contaminated and losing their saltiness. A watchman cannot become entangled with the world. He has to stay in his tower. He has to stay in the presence. He has to stay up high. He has to stay in that atmosphere. He has to stay in that dimension. He has to stay in the glory. He's a watchman. Stay above the world to proclaim to the world. You got to challenge the world and hold true to the word of God. You got to be like Elijah. If God be God, then let's serve him. If he's not, forget it. But if he is, let's go in. Yes. Quit playing games. Yes. We got to take up the mantle and be bold. Whatever's not grounded in him and his word will be shaken in this hour. Plugged into the word of God. As for me and my house, we shall serve the Lord. You have to have decided, like that old song says, I have decided I will follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, no turning back. You got to be on the offensive. Greater is he who's in you than he who's in the world. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of God. It's the power of salvation. Our identity as salt and light is being stolen through deception. How can we regain our effectiveness to be salt and light? You know what? Living in righteousness.
Right.
If contamination has come by the way of the world's influence, which it has, or the society in which we live in, the logical answer, be less worldly. Get rid of the contamination.
Amen.
Not by law and regulations, but by falling in love with Jesus. It just takes care of it. I didn't have a law. I couldn't find it in the Bible. Do not go to prom. I could find several things that might suggest it, but okay, I'll give this to you. I did not find, Debbie, you are born again. Do not go to your prom. But I did find that I'm a peculiar people. And I did find that I'm the righteousness of Christ. And I knew none of that was going to be there. And basically, we're back to something we talked about the last couple of nights. He touched me, and it was over. It was over. That power destroys sin in our lives. It does not coincide with it. We are a peculiar people. A minister named Bob Fraley said this, I'm not interested in providing you a feel-good spiritual high that leaves your spiritual health unchanged. Salt is one of the most stable compounds out there. It can't lose its saltiness on its own, even if it gets old. Only if it becomes contaminated, mixed, or diluted with another substance. It has to remain different from the medium in which it's placed. And it only takes a little of, you know, it's that to flavor something. It only takes, oh, how are we ever going to get to be the majority? It only takes a few of us. It only takes a Gideon's army that knows how to drink. It only takes some people that can see the truth. It only takes some people who won't bend, won't bow, won't compromise to get the job done. We are that people, folks. That's why I'm here tonight. We are that people. Whoa. There's a lot of scriptures about light. We were once in darkness, now we're in the light. Walk as children of the light. The world's in darkness, folks. Yet they continue to talk about their enlightenment because they've traded in our God for the gods of their own minds and their own brilliance, which is nothing but foolishness and nothing but stupidity and will cause their own downfall. But we've got to take in the true light of God, and where the light shines, sin is exposed. Pastor Rodney used to say it like this, when the fire comes, then the light comes. And when the light comes, the cockroaches start to move around. And many times in revival, you're like, what happened to that little nice person that's mad and stomping around? I went in a meeting with you, Pastor. And what happens when you preach a message like this? Light comes, fire comes, and the cockroaches start right up your neck. And I don't know, this isn't quite like her. Fire and Jesus and wine and spiritual wine and rivers and messages. What has happened to this lady? This lady wants to preach and teach the whole counsel of God in an hour where there's so much of it that is so absent. We're not going to replace God's wisdom for man's wisdom. I'm not going to read all the scriptures. Suffice it to say that. Light exposes sin. The devil knows his time is short. He's trying to destroy us, trying to destroy our nation, trying to destroy the church. The world needs a preservation of light and salt. You are it.
Yes. Yes.
But if you're all mixed up, compromising, you can't salt anything. And you're not going to be a light anywhere. James 4:4, you adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. 1 John 2:15-16, tell us not to love the world, neither the things in it. This is pretty simple, folks. 1 John 2:15-16, I'm not reading the whole thing, but you go back and read some of these. We're in the world, but we're not of it. We're living here, yeah, we can't isolate ourselves in a little cave with a piece of bread humming. We're supposed to be witnesses. But how can we be a witness when they can't tell the difference between us and them? Conviction. Oh, there's a word. That everybody has changed into another word. You want to guess what it is?
Condemnation.
We had a couple come into our church living together, not married. I found that out the first week. I thought, okay, Debbie, don't say everything you want to say. Hold back. Love on them. Show them the truth. We do that week after week after week after week. Finally, I talked to her. She goes, well, I know we're not quite as good of a testimony as we could be. I don't think that's what the Bible calls it. I would understand if you don't want me to be in the worship team or something. Okay, let's start over. And we end up, and then they're too poor to get married, and then this, and then that. We tell them we'll pay for the wedding. We tell them we'll take them to the courthouse. We tell them we will help them. And she told me off, called me the F word, said I was legalistic. And I went, that is what we encounter in the church today.
Yeah.
When you preach the truth. Yeah. Conviction versus condemnation. When a person hears a message that is meant to expose sin and refuses to acknowledge it if there is sin, that causes them to receive it as condemnation rather than to simply be convicted of sin and repent. The story of the woman caught in adultery in John 8, not going to read it, verses 7 through 11. The scribes and Pharisees had caught her. She's probably a prostitute. Jesus is teaching in the temple. You know the story. The Mosaic law required she be stoned to death. They tried to trick Jesus. He ignores their repeated questioning, finally writes in the ground, you're right, he who is without sin cast the first stone. They all depart. You know the story. He says, are all your accusers gone? Yes, neither do I. Neither do I accuse you. Neither do I condemn you. But he says, go and sin no more. Boy, today that sentence would be condemnation. Yeah. Go and sin no more. Oh, you shouldn't call it sin. You shouldn't, to each his own. She knows her heart. And God knows her heart. Yeah, that's why Jesus had to say, go and sin no more. Now, he forgave her. He defended the adulteress, but he did not defend the adultery. Cut it off. I've forgiven you. You're free. Live a different way. That's always been his message, always will be his message. So again, all behavior, thought that is sinful before forgiveness is still sinful after forgiveness. He wasn't afraid to call sin a sin. He called it sin. He wasn't afraid to call a sinner a sinner. He even reminded her of her sin. They'd say today, you shouldn't have said, go and sin no more. You reminded her of what? Yeah? Don't forget that I freed you from this. Don't go back to it. Now, I'm gonna close with this. It's just getting way too lengthy here. Maybe I'll come back for part two sometime.
Absolutely.
But I want to close with this. How many have ever had quoted to your face Matthew 7:7? No matter what you say. Oh, judge not that you be not judged. That is replaced John 3:16, it's been said, as the verse that everybody in the world knows. I don't know another scripture in the Bible, but they know that one. And I was reading an article a couple of years ago by a minister actually from Northern California, so it's not too far up the road. And I thought it was one of the best articles I ever read. All he did was go to a restaurant and say Merry Christmas to somebody, and boy, did he get in trouble. Remember a day that nobody would have gotten in trouble? Everybody said Merry Christmas, whether they knew the Lord, whether they didn't. But oh, he got in trouble, and I'm going to read this. He says, I live in Northern California, ground zero for liberalism. They're constantly telling people not to judge. Their hilarious hypocrisy is breathtaking. Bay Area liberals are the most judgmental people on the planet. I have lived under environmental, nutritional, gender, Sharia law most of my adult life. Last December in Danville, California, I said Merry Christmas to my waiter. He scowled at me and said, I do not want to exclude anyone. Talk about a hair trigger. Everything on earth is a cause for liberals. How do they sleep at night with so much judging to do? They judge food. They judge animal treatment. They judge gardening, the car you drive, even your fireplace. Judge, judge, judge. To them, it's a world filled with is. You're either sexist, elitist, capitalist, fascist, racist, and now because of animal rights, there are species. People who believe humans are a higher species than man. He says, Christians, we better wake up. Don't take Jesus out of context just so you can hide in a deeply immoral nation. Tolerance mongers seem to have found the one absolute truth they're willing to live by. How many times have you heard someone say, judge not, lest you be judged? The statement has become the great American open-mindedness mantra. When anyone has the courage to declare that someone else's belief, actions, or lifestyle is morally amiss. Another form of the same non-judgmental judgment is that may be true for you. This is my favorite one.
Oh, yeah.
That may be true for you, but it's not true for me.
Oh, yeah.
The logic behind the statement, and I thought about, even as I was getting ready to read this tonight, I thought about how your pastor, even though he's such a Holy Ghost man, when it comes to natural things, he's the most logical. He knows how to tear something apart. And I thought, he's going to love this. And the logic behind the statement goes something like this. Your truth is your truth, and my truth is my truth. We are both right, and I hold to my opinion of truth. And then he says, the last time I checked, it was impossible for two chairs to occupy the same place around my dining room table. But evidently, such rules of time, space, and logic don't apply to tolerance philosophy. Postmodernism's live and let live concept of truth argues that even two opposite and wholly contradictory claims can both be true. That does sound kind of like Common Core or something today. This is as stupid as saying that black and white are the same color. Yet it clarifies the absurdity of the postmodernism that we're all supposed to blithely accept as the fundamental principle by which we respond to each other's ideas. The please and thank you of philosophical respect. So beware. If you dare claim that another person's truth is not, in fact, truth, but is, in fact, wrong, you are not only being intolerant, but you are also being, mantra forbid, judgmental. In his book, True for You, But Not for Me, Paul Copan describes the fallacy in this all-too-common thinking. It's been said that the most frequently quoted Bible verse is no longer John 3:16, but Matthew 7:1. Do not judge, or you too will be judged. We can't glibly quote this, though, without understanding what Jesus meant. When Jesus condemned judging, he wasn't at all implying we should never make judgments about anyone. Please listen to this carefully, because this is so under attack right now. After all, a few verses later, Jesus himself calls certain people pigs and dogs in Matthew 7:6, and wolves in sheep's clothing in Matthew 7:15. What Jesus condemns is a critical and judgmental spirit, an unholy sense of superiority. Jesus commanded us to examine ourselves first to the problems we so easily see in others. Only then can we remove the speck in my brother's eye. But if I can remove it after that, I must have to judge that there's a speck there. Which incidentally assumes that a problem exists and must be confronted. Those that tell you not to judge, quoting Matthew 7:1, grossly out of context, are often some of the most mean-spirited, judgmental souls you could ever meet. Have you noticed that? It's not, of course, that they don't want anyone to judge anything, because they want very much to judge and condemn. Your commitment to lovingly speak and practice your Christian conviction. I'm going to change the word he uses. I don't like it. Your Christian worldview. No, I don't like that. You see how these tolerance rules work? We must tolerate them, but they don't have to tolerate us. Get a hold of this. The logic is consistent anyway. Today's postmodern culture of adults and students are so consumed by non-judgmentalism that there are some who would say we should not even call wrong or evil the terrorist attacks on September 11th, 2011. I'm not going to read you the article, but in Time Magazine, in one of our leading colleges, they were all allowed to say what they did was no different than we have done in any nation of the world, even though our soldiers were not asked to target civilians, were not asked to do these things. And it goes on to talk about the view today in colleges is if you defend yourself, if you defend your nation, if you defend anyone, you are intolerant, you are judgmental. That is the society that we live in. And he talks about how he raised his hand, the professor wouldn't let him speak. Do you know that Paul tells us, what's wrong with you that you couldn't judge these matters in the church?
That's right.
He said, don't you even know you'll be judging angels? There are plenty of verses in here. How can we even judge sin in our lives? How can we even judge if something's right or wrong if we judge nothing? Talk about the devil taking something out of context to cause us to say we can't even call right right and we can't call wrong wrong and maybe it's what anybody thinks it is. That has to be done in the church because there is a right. There is a wrong. There is a truth. There is a lie. There is freedom. There is bondage. There is heaven. There is hell. There is victory. There is enslavement to sin. And we have the power to not let any of that junk touch us. Why would we pet it? Why would we compromise with it? Why would we bring it into our home like a little pet and make a box for it and say, I've said the prayer, I'm going to heaven now, I can live any way I want to? The people that practice that stuff, we have scripture over scripture, enough that I did read and much more that I didn't, that anybody who practices these things shall not see the kingdom of heaven, has no part in him, he has no part in you and I if we participate with that stuff. All the church
Amen.
Used to know that. But we're living in a society when faith teachers, river teachers, when I say that, of course, not Pastor Rod, you understand what I'm talking about. People who lay hold of some truths in a certain camp, so to speak, come in and I'm a river person, I'm a faith person, I'm a Holy Ghost person. I know I said I'd close with that. One more thing. I was in a place a few years ago where I was asked to speak with several people. And the man that got up that night, it was so demonic. And I've had to plow through some stuff in fleshly demonstrations and people that wouldn't listen, but I've never seen any such a demonic display of weird manifestations. And if I told you and showed you, you'd just go, no way. I just knew everybody in there could see that. And I knew I couldn't have any more participation in these meetings as long as he was there. So I go to the person in charge and I'm like, no, Debbie, you can't be judgmental. He's young. I didn't take it that way. I'm like, what? But thank God there was another minister or two that did. And so several of us met with the man. He said, you're all a bunch of religious Pharisees who've never tasted of the Holy Ghost in your life. I'm like, really? What have these last 25 years been? And then he starts naming some of his mentors, some of the people that have been well known and fallen publicly and other. Anyway, the Holy Ghost revealed some things to me, and I didn't even quite realize it. I got up the next night. I'm talking about the real river versus a muddy swamp. And once you've tasted of the real, why would you ever want any of this? And I thought, I'm not going to use his name. I'm not going to use his manifestations. I'm not going to be that obvious. I don't want to attack the man. I just want to help the people. And so I use somebody else that I saw their weird stuff on a YouTube. I'm like, it was the worst I've ever seen. Comes to find out, that's one of his main mentors. And I wouldn't have known that, but he wrote on Facebook, these religious Pharisees tried to stop me. And this man that I've been talking about said, we should have never posted some of our YouTube videos and given it away, what we all believe. I'm like, oh, the very examples I use, this is who he's hooked up with. I mean, he had named some other people, but he didn't name this guy. And I just wept because guess what? After I left, some people who could see the truth told me that the other ones who couldn't see the truth said, man, Debbie, listen to this. Debbie used to be so free, and we had so much joy and so many great manifestations, and she's getting religious. But this guy, he's just, this guy, It's worse than flesh. He is demonized. And he was laying his hands on everybody, and I saw stuff happening to these other people. And I went, God, this may not be a Friday night blowout, but I want true revival, and I want lasting revival. And even though you might be saying, well, why don't you deliver it in another church where we don't hear this stuff about holiness, and we don't, because sometimes one of the enemy's tricks is it's only your pastor who's sold. And you need to hear other voices that God's speaking the same thing to, saying, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord. And those of you watching by way of YouTube or who may watch it later, I'm telling you, if you're somewhere where there is this horrible mixture and you're being taught you can live any way you want to, you will find yourself in hell one of these days remembering this message. And I beg you, I plead with you to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and have a true conversion. Whether you ever have one or didn't, I'm not even going to touch that. But if you're living that way now, you lost it somewhere along the line, and you've got to get under that blood and get under that grace and get under that name and repent again and turn from your wicked ways and meet the Savior at the cross of Calvary. I wish there were still some people here tonight that I was feeling by the Holy Ghost earlier in the week. Man, they got to repent. They got to come. They got to come. I may go home going, God, did I do the wrong night? But you're here. And I didn't sense him wanting me to change this. Folks, it's gonna have to get more narrow and more narrow. Yes. There's a wide, easy way that everybody's taken. The Bible says that. Yes. This is a narrow. Yes. A narrow is an including sin and debauchery and fornication and all these manifestations from hell. A narrow road is you and you only, Jesus. Yes. You and you only. This is how the church will become the church. We're not going to have any lasting signs and wonders without holiness. Right. May have some weird stuff happening that nobody's ever seen that will cause more problems than it's helped anybody, but it won't be manifestations of the Holy Ghost. Right. We want to do it His way. Yeah. We want to do it His way. Hallelujah. Right. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask every head to be bowed, every eye closed. We plowed it straight down the middle tonight. And perhaps when I asked earlier, perhaps you thought, no, I'm saved and I've been here a while. And, you know, I said the sinner's prayer and you thought everything was fine. But when we just start delivering the word of the Lord, you're like, oh, Lord, I'm compromising with the world. I'm playing the part of a harlot. I'm flirting with all the devil's stuff. And just saying I got a free ride because I said the prayer once upon a time. And you may be saying tonight, I want to come all the way home like that song says, though none go with me, still I will follow. I will follow. Coming all the way home, Lord. I'm not just saying a prayer. I'm not just coming in the fun manifestation night. I'm not just joining a social group here. I'm not just easing my conscience. Lord, I want to be sold out to you. Sin has no place in my life. I don't care what has happened in my life. I don't care. I can blame it on mom and dad. I can blame it on something that happened to me. We talked about that and dealt with it last night. No, we have victory and we have power. Oh, I don't care if you were mistreated and you were mistreated the worst of anyone on the planet. God's bigger than that. And in one moment, He can do enough spiritual surgery. That thing doesn't torment you. You don't sit and think about it. You don't sit and wallow in it. You don't sit and make excuses for it. You say, no more. No more. I have victory over sin. I have victory over sin. I have victory over depression. I have victory over suicide spirits. I have victory over any kind of oppression out there. I have victory. I don't care how long it's been going on. Tonight it changes in Jesus' name. I'm not going to permit it. I'm not going to tolerate it. I'm going to be intolerant of sin in my life. And I'm coming all the way home in Jesus' name. If that's you, and God would have sent me down from Washington if it was one person. And the enemy might say, oh, you know this is the kind of message hardly nobody's going to go and answer except you. They're going to wonder what you... We'll just head him off right there with his stupid lies. Nobody is going to do anything except rejoice and know that there's an honest heart in the building. And that there is somebody who means so much business, they don't care. Nobody else is in the auditorium. It's just them and Jesus. Remember me when I wouldn't go up? The story I told last night, can't go up. They know there's a call of God in my life. I'll look like a failure. And I was a failure at the moment. But I had to face up to that and say, clean me out. Forgive me. I have victory over this no matter what situation I'm in. If any of those things apply to you and you just sense the Holy Spirit tugging at your heart tonight to just get totally cleansed by the blood of the Lamb and rededicate your life, whatever you want to call it, but you're coming to Jesus. You say no to hell, no to sin, no to bondage, no to habits, and yes to everything that He is. If that's you, I want you to lift your hand right now in Jesus' name. Thank you. Honest hearts. Yes, Jesus. Honest hearts. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Hands still going up. And I know that I'm not preaching anything different from what your pastor preaches, but I couldn't get away from it today. Couldn't get away from it. I would have liked to have preached something more popular, something we had more fun with. But again, I too must say yes to your will and way. And when I see these hands going up, oh, how worth it it is. And those of you out there in YouTube land, I tell you what, when these come up here and we pray, you come to Jesus, you repent of your sin, you ask Him to forgive you and wash you in His blood, you forget all these silly doctrines that are out there and quit trying to call it just, I'm a little out of fellowship, I'm not right where, and just call it sin and say, forgive me, I need to come to you and make you Savior and Lord of my life tonight. In Jesus' name, I'm going to ask all of you who raised your hands, or those of you who should have, it's not too late to come. Come. Come in Jesus' name. You won't be alone. Several hands went up. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is awesome. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Brosagreske. I also realize that in moments like these, people at all sensitive to the Holy Spirit, I'm like that. Somebody gives an altar call. Sometimes I've sat and wept when Pastor Rodney was preaching, and he came off the platform and he goes, Debbie, that wasn't meant for you. And I said, I know that, but I don't want any area. I don't want any area to remain like that. And any place I felt a little tug or a little adjustment needs to be made, I'm going to go, come on, Lord. So I realize some people may be up here like that tonight. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Because you're all saying yes to His holiness and His ways and being completely sold out to Him. So I'm just going to ask you, you know how I'm going to do it tonight? I just feel everybody up here knows enough. Call out to Him. All of you just start calling out to Him. Asking Him any way you want to ask Him to forgive you, to cleanse you, to deliver you. Tell Him that you're saying no to sin, that you know that in Him you have victory over all sin, over all bondages, all habits. Just grab a hold of Him tonight and say, Lord, Lord, forgive me, cleanse me. I make you Savior and Lord of my life. I'm forsaking all sin, all compromise, any doctrines of devils. Any feeling sorry for myself, any giving myself an excuse, no more excuses. I'm an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of my testimony. So Jesus, by the Holy Spirit tonight, do a work in my heart where I turn away from all sin and I know that I know that I'm born again. I'm free. I'm cleansed. I'm saved. Fill me with your Spirit. Use me. Change me. In Jesus' name. Now I just want you to start talking to him. You don't have to do my prayer exactly like that. The reality of your spirit, the reality of your conviction, the reality of your heart change, Lord, the reality of your blood upon this life. In Jesus' mighty name. Oh, for that cleansing blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. Oh, the blood of Jesus that washes white as snow. Oh, the blood of Jesus. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow. That makes me white as snow. There's no compromise with that. There's no hugging sin with that. To see a young man at this age totally yielding himself to you, Lord, saying, Jesus, I just want to follow you all the days of my life and only you, not the world, not anything else, nothing else, nothing else, no counterfeit can even come close to what you offer, Lord. He leaves this place tonight so free, knowing that he knows that he knows that he knows that he knows. I am saved. I belong to Jesus. He belongs to me. And I never want anything but him. Jesus. Jesus. The hand of the Lord is upon you this night. The hand of the Lord is upon you this night. Not only to forgive, not only to wash you clean of any sin, but the hand of the Lord is upon you to use you. The hand of the Lord is upon you until you become unrecognizable. The hand of the Lord is upon you to show others how real he is. Oh God, getting them at this age and putting a Holy Ghost backbone of steel in them where they won't bend, they won't bow, they won't compromise. I will serve no other gods nor any other foreign thing. For you are my God. You are my God. I will not bow to anything, any man-made doctrine, any man-made idol. I will bow to nothing but the Lord Jesus Christ and him crucified. Fill him, Lord, where nothing can compare with your glory. Nothing can compare. He will say, I've tasted of the real. Why would I want that? Jesus. Oh, Lord, for everybody up here tonight. Oh, this is awesome. But I got to tell you, looking in the faces of these young people that aren't having a casual touch here, it's just like, oh God, how do I get picked to get to look at these faces? Jesus, 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 how old are you, sweetheart? Ah, I was hoping for that answer. It wouldn't have mattered what answer it was, but I was 12. And I knew the hand of the Lord was upon me to preach the gospel, to set the captive free. Jesus! Jesus. 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 Sold out, unbendable, uncompromising, and he who the Son sets free is free indeed. Oh, Rabingo Rishamato Gori Zambo Tele de Preche Preke. I'm so glad you still came.
Thank you.
Jesus, I thank you for this woman, this precious woman, who says, no, I can't resist any longer, Lord. As long as I'm getting any nudging, I've got to obey you. Lord, how you honor that. How you meet her right here. How you meet her right here. Because you were drawing her to take her into a place she has not yet seen, not yet touched, not yet been in. The place of perfect, perfect. The place of that blood being so real. Of sanctification. Of a cruel sapa. Chambre se. Jambrisa papatara baso. Jombli sikiti lebe preche crossa botol. Jesus. 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 Bokara masombreske. As much as you enjoy the joy, as much as you enjoy the manifestations, oh, tonight, much deeper. Much deeper. Jesus. 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 Would you all stand with me for a moment? I tell you by the Holy Ghost, some of you that say, I understand that healing is mine and the atonement, but I don't know why I can't get this breakthrough here to have the manifestation of healing in my body. Of course, we don't buy our healing. Of course, we don't do good works unto our healing. He bore our sin in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed. That it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Is any sick among you? Let them call for the elders of the church and let them pray over them, anointing them with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. Yeah, you know that. But I tell you by the Holy Ghost, as some adjustments are made, Lord, I've had this area over here with a little compromise. I've had this area over here. I just thought my pastors were sort of legalistic. I've had this little area over here. You watch as you say, Lord, take it all. Take it all. Take it all. How the revelation of what he did, because as long as that vision is a little cloudy, as long as that vision is not single focused on him, on his work, on his cross, there are blind spots there where we may know something mentally, but it's not real to our heart. Even tonight, as some of you make those adjustments right now, oh Jesus, your holiness, your word, your blood, your spirit, nothing else, nothing else. And now, Lord, with clear vision, I see the work that you did for me in every area. And I take my healing now in Jesus' name. I take what I need now in Jesus' name. I take that provision that I need now in Jesus' name. I take that word of wisdom I need right now in Jesus' name. I take that direction right now in Jesus' name. I thank you that I hear clearly. I see clearly. There is nothing obscuring that and blocking that in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now, Lord, tonight, as your people have stuck around for a long time for a lengthy word about your power to save to the uttermost, and your cleansing blood and your holiness, and how you, the righteousness of Christ, became mine when I was born again. Lord, I pray that they leave this place knowing that they know who they belong to, who they're following, with no compromise in any area, and that they will hold their own and not be ashamed of your gospel, even when they're talking to people. That yes, it's the goodness of God that leads man to repentance, but there is the severity of God, that they will be able to, as be led by the Holy Ghost, be able to show people the truth in any area without fear of repercussion, without fear of political correctness or spiritual correct. The only spiritual correct position is yours, Lord, that they shall preach up boldly in Jesus' name, and not compromise it in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you so much, Lord Jesus. Thank you so much, Heavenly Father. Thank you so much, Holy Spirit. You know, you're so blessed. We are so blessed. To they have such an army and company of people that are, that come here to minister in the church. And I'm telling you, to me, Evangelist Debbie Rester stands at the very top of the list. And we have been so blessed. Listen, we labor to see people of the Spirit come forth. People of the Spirit have learned how to walk in a fellowship with the Lord Jesus Christ and an intimacy that when prayer goes down and is needed, heaven fills the place. They know how to function, flow in the gifts of the Spirit. They know how to preach the word. The love of God saturates their being. The things of this world just has no appeal. They're able to just begin to, you know, slightest little movement of heaven, grab a hold of all that Father has made available and just run with it. People, we want you to be those kinds of folks. People of the Spirit. People so full of the Word, so full of God, so full of the Holy Ghost, so full of faith. They're not flighty. They're solid as a rock. They're not here. They're not there. They're not looking for all the various differing excuses. Listen, I woke up, I think it was either yesterday morning or this morning. I can't remember which one. But I woke up and the Lord said, and it spoke to me, something to declare to this individual. And this is what it was. God the Holy Ghost convinces of sin, but He uses our mouth. And you think about that. God the Holy Ghost convinces of sin, but He uses our mouth. That He has to use our mouth in such a way where we're speaking the word by the authority that only God the Holy Ghost can bring. And we want to teach you how to move in that realm. We want to teach you how to go there. We don't want you to be heady people. And you know that. I go after that all the time. Just imitate us. Just do what we do. Because so many people will just go so far and they won't imitate. They want to be the individual. Imitate us. There's so many people to imitate in here. Imitate Anlin. Imitate Jacqueline. Imitate Elizabeth. Imitate Ruth Ann. I could just go down the list. You know, I'm watching as Zoe and Claire and others are just stepping in. Deborah. Imitate them. Watch what happens when the moving of the Spirit begins to take place. They're not sitting there all stoic looking. They're not sitting there with a dead expression. There's tears, there's laughter, there's movement, there's something so deep. If you weren't in our School of Spirit a week ago this Friday, which was the title of it was Making the Connection. You have to listen to that till you get it. Listen till you get it. There is an encounter. There is a place where you so deeply touched by the Holy Ghost. And you stay there. It's not just once a month, once a week. You stay there, deeply touched. And that's why everything that God talks about, what He touches, is so deep. Out of your kolia, your passions, your emotions. Out of your heart. Out of your bowels of compassion. Think about it. That's people of the Spirit. That's people of the Spirit. You have to imitate us. You have to do what we do. Huh? Because we followed those that were before us. We watched them. I've watched so many people come in and immediately. I mean, I watched Anlin step in. It wasn't a week. It wasn't a month. It was more like a week. It wasn't long. She just stepped right in. Just step in. The Father's no respecter of persons. He doesn't leave people out. He doesn't leave anyone out. This is one thing for certain, though. Any compromise with sin and any compromise with the world will keep you from ever going there. Any unwillingness to surrender and give it all will keep you from going there. Thank you, Jesus. Just jump in tonight. Just jump in. I want you to understand something. There is nothing that I do of myself. I have learned how to let God the Holy Ghost master me. He is my ruler. I move in Him. I read the Bible because I'm compelled by the Holy Ghost. I pray because I'm overwhelmed by the movings of the Spirit. I dance because I'm taken into the realms of a display of emotional love and thanksgiving. All by the Holy Ghost. Nothing of me. I just give myself over to the Lord. I just learned to yield to Him. And there's some people here tonight. And I'm so glad that you're here tonight. You need to learn how to yield to Him. You need to quit walking your own route. You need to keep walking and doing it your own way. There is a place where you can find yourself singing this song right here that Joshua is playing all day long. Be caught away. There is a place. Just the Roman Tampadana keeps the beat as it keeps coming flowing out. You got to get a hold of yourself just to kind of, just as the do remain as the bena mata keep it, just to stop a lot of bit fear. What's the proof? A little while. You know that, Satona? And then all of a sudden you find yourself going from Bamaravidendas to the Yanamonkataya to the English language, and you discover how seamless tongues and interpretation of tongues are. And how that out of it comes an awareness and a consciousness and a revelation and a wisdom and a divine insight and a strength and a divine power that looks like the very power and strength of the Lord, His own might. It's called Pentecost. It's called baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of you were able to be here every night with us? Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I so wanted everybody that came the first night to come every night. And I wanted everybody that came the second night to come every night. But, you know, there'll come a time in your life where there's nothing more important to you than seeking the Lord. And being in His presence, and you're not picky, and you don't have any excuses, and you don't have any, you know, there's no reasons why, because you just, your heart's captured, captivated. Till then, you're going to have a lot of problems. You're going to have a lot of issues. You're going to have a lot of sin you don't know how to overcome. You're going to have a lot of circumstances that will rule you. But if you just come running to Jesus, heaven take hold of you. You get caught away, hallelujah, and all those issues will be gone. My dear friend, one of my dear friends is standing in here tonight. He's gonna know that he can. He's gonna know exactly what I'm talking about. Many years ago, he came to me. He said, "I really don't know if I'm yielding to the Lord or not. I really don't know where the break point is." And I said, "Well, listen." Are you living the life of the overcomer? Are you successful in the things that you purpose to do in God? He says, no. I said, well, that's all you. Well, how do I learn how to walk in the Spirit? Really easy. Get in all the meetings. I have so many people. I have people email me. I have people call me. I'm walking down the street. I have people say, call me pastor, and I haven't seen them in church for a year. I'm like, what? You know, somebody said, oh, just take it. It's just respect. Well, you know, whatever. At any rate, I know how to get your problems solved. Come to the meetings. All of the meetings. And if you don't want to come to the meetings, then let God show you what your problem is. Because it's not going to be solved for you in the home. And on your own. It's in the house. It's in the house. Connection with the Holy Ghost is in His church. It's in His church. It's right here in the church. Another big thing that Satan is attacking within all these realms of these heresy doctrines that are going down. Oh, you don't need to be in church. What the Holy Ghost is doing is in the midst of the church. What Jesus is doing is in the midst of the church. Kingdom first is the church. Kingdom's church. It's expressed by the church. All the gifts of the Spirit, the working, the moving, the power of God, the perfecting, the strengthening in the midst of the church. Just understand this. I'm going to lay it on you, okay? Because we're kind of closing. I don't really want to wrap this up for a couple of people. You're as committed to God as you are to the church. You love Jesus Christ as much as you love the church. You seek the kingdom as much as you are in the meeting. You're as hooked up with the Holy Ghost as you are hooked up with His body. That is reality. There's not a preacher who knows the Word of God and is a person of the Spirit that is not going to say that amen to that. The only people that are going to disagree with that are people who don't do that because they don't believe that. And they don't do that and they don't believe it because they understood the Word. It's just because they want to do what they want to do. You do what we command you to do. And get over yourself. Another thing that the demonic realm hates, authority. Someone to have the rule over you. You know what? I don't care what anybody says. And it is not control. I don't control anyone. Control is a very different realm. But I'm going to take the authority. And I'm going to have the rule. Control will make you do it. I will have the authority and I will have the rule and you will choose to do it. And I won't love you either way. But the reality of it is you can never have what God has for you till you do it His way. And from Matthew 7:21 to 1 John 2:17, it's those who do the will of the Father. The world and the lust thereof shall pass away, but he that does the will of the Father shall abide forever. I'm abiding. I'm not going to hell. I was 4 years old. My dad was preaching a fiery sermon on hell. I was in a tent. Sawdust floor, and I came running up from the back screaming, Daddy, I don't want to go to hell. And I haven't changed my opinion on that at all. I mean, I was screaming top of my lungs. I was scared to death. I was like, ah! Because by the time he brought, God finished, man. And that, you know, this was still the days of great Holy Ghost conviction, which is rarer anywhere. You have to be a person of the Spirit who knows how to take over the atmosphere that dominates much of the church community to have true Holy Ghost shaking conviction. People shake over a lot of things, but shaking over the reality of the fear of God, which most people call a message of condemnation. It's not a message of condemnation. The Word of God convinces men of sin. God the Holy Ghost convinces of sin. If I can get people to take verses of Scripture, I've had a person come to me. They just came to me. I had all these, on Wednesday, have all these folks around me saying they need this and that, need that. And they've not been in one of the meetings. And they say they want to know God, but they've not been in one of the meetings. They want me to meet with them and cast out the devil and take authority over this and that thing and the other thing. No! That ain't what it's about. It's about you getting right with God and coming under authority. And I tell you right now, you as much under authority to God as you are as under authority to me. You're as connected to God as you are connected to his ministers. We're his mouthpiece, and that's the way he set it up. People don't want to hear it, but the reality of it is, those who don't want to hear it, their hearts made manifest, they not of God. They want to do it their own way. And it's never his way, and they can never have the fruits of those things which he's freely given. But we love you. And the arms are still open, and the mercy is still there. But quit blaming it on God. Quit coming up with all these other excuses, and quit coming up with all these other opinions, and acting like you know yourself something when fundamentally you're not obeying, because you're not under the rule. We pray that from this day forward, you'll know those who have the rule over you, and you will give them double honor. Hallelujah. I pray that in the name of Jesus, because there's a connection. There is a connection with God the Holy Ghost that is going to come because you're willing to submit yourself to God. And when you do that, it shows in every area of your life. And if you'll be clothed with humility and walk in love, I promise you right now, you're going to get yourself an understanding of the blood of Jesus. And you're going to get yourself a revelation of the one who died on the altar called Calvary. Cross, and you're going to see the glory and majesty of when he came up busting forth from the grave, and suddenly there in the tomb the sun arose in the brightness of his glory. You're going to see him seated at the right hand of the Father, passionate about you, and everything changes. Everything changed. Everything changes tonight. I came to the meeting in full expectation that Jesus would come to me. I wanted to be able to visibly see him, but he came to me. He came to me. He did. He came to me while I was worshiping. He's come to me all through the night with his word. He's come to me all through the night with the manifestation of his presence. You know, when you guys came up here, people say, how often should I come? Go till you know. Go to the altar till you know. Go. Just keep coming. Ain't nobody upset about it. Just go till you know. But when you begin to see him rejoice over us. And we can't even see. We don't have the discernment to understand how excited he is, how in love he is. But oh, what happens when we hang out with him and suddenly we begin to see that? We start dancing with him. We start moving with him. And this love thing starts getting really, 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 really big. You can do it your way if you want, but you're not going to get there. I said you can do it your way if you want, but you're not going to get there. The only way that you're going to be where he is to do it his way. The only way that you're going to have the life of the overcomer, the one who's more than a conqueror, the one who's living in him and he's living in them, this wonderful place where the glorious realms of heaven bust forth on out of your innermost being. You don't look like a man. You look like a person born again, a new creation. You look like a person taken over by the Holy Ghost. People, I want you to say this with me tonight. I want you to say, Lord,
I want to be
a person of the Spirit.
A person of the Spirit.
And so therefore, I consecrate myself. And I devote myself to living in you, Holy Spirit. To walking in you, Holy Spirit. To being led by you, Holy Spirit. And I want you to listen to this. everything that the Holy Spirit is doing, everything that He is saying, everything that He is inspiring, everything that He's leading us into is the truth, which is the Word of truth, which is the Word of God. He is only here to manifest the Word made flesh. He's only here to make alive and real the Word that is written, which the Word made flesh personified. You got your test. I believe with all of my heart that this thing that the Lord has given us to do, that He's commissioned us to do, and that we have faithfully done and we have not let up, will ultimately result in the body of Christ being revealed. The body of Christ is not revealed without the manifestation of the Holy Ghost in the purest way that it was expressed through Jesus, as it's understood in the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, the discerning of spirits, the working of miracles, the gifts of healing, the gift of faith, prophecy, tongues, interpretation of tongues, all of these things that are just wrought by God the Holy Ghost in the context of holiness, in the context of an overwhelming, earth-shaking, mountain-leaping manifestation of the holiness of God, which demands of you and me consecration to His ways. I do not want to join myself to the expressions that do not come out of consecration to holies of holies. That which is going on in Father's presence, that's what's going on and is operated by the Holy Ghost. And this is absolutely the demarcation line. This is why we preach. This is why we worship. This is why we do everything that we do, so you will begin to understand the line of demarcation. And you'll come over here and you'll be sanctified with the sanctification that He has sanctified us with. You come over here and live in this life, in other words. Amen. See, think about everybody in here. I really don't have to get a word of knowledge because I know everything about you. The Father knows more. And I'm patient with you, but He's far more patient. And I love you, but He loves you a whole lot more. But that don't mean you're ever going to get there. That don't mean you're ever going to get there. You have to absolutely conform to doing His way, and that means every bit of self-will must be stripped out of your life. If you want to do it God's way, you're going to have to learn how to walk in such love that you become the slave, the servant to everyone. Amen. And that might sound bad to you, but it sounds really good to me. You know why it sounds so good to me? Because that's who God is. That's His ways. That's what He does. That's Him. Tonight's your last opportunity to hook up for a miracle with Pastor Bob and Debbie Rester, and by way of giving. And everybody in here knows what I mean when I say that. Hallelujah. Because every time we give and participate in the ministry that is in someone else's life, we're hooking up in a miraculous realm that has every form of provision in it. Every form of provision. Every form of provision. Every form of provision. Obedience is always right there, right in the midst of every form of provision. So get your checks ready. If you're given by way of more debt card, that's fine too. Better to go into debt for the kingdom of God than for whatever little shiny object that might have caught your eye. You know what I'm saying? How many people here tonight, you're not planning on giving? Would you raise your hand? I'd like to see tonight how many people are not planning on giving anything in the offering. I just like to see. Hey, Jesus stood over at the offering basket and he watched what everybody put in. He's like, good job. Or, so no one raised their hand. Now I'm going to tell you right now, all liars shall have their part in the lake of fire. All liars will have their part in the lake of fire. So if you lie tonight, you can repent. But it's a little bit uncertain as to whether or not you can plan on sinning and then repent afterwards to whether that is really qualifies as true repentance. So once again, with the uplifted hand, and you're a liar if you don't lift your hand, if you're doing otherwise. How many of you planning on not giving tonight? You're not planning on giving. You're not giving tonight. Praise God. Every one of you going to give. Amen. In Jesus' name. That's good. And the thing about it is that's between you and the Lord, what you give, whether it's a penny, whether it's whatever it is, whether it's $1 million. Whatever the Lord is. We haven't gotten to give in the offering basket $1 million yet, but we're going for it. And you know how we're going to get there? We're going to give all the dollars we got now. Because people talk, well, they're going to do it. You're not going to do it until you give abundantly now, because God ain't going to, because God's going to cause you to realize that he's the supernatural living God who actually gives these kinds of things to those who will obey him, miracles. And he's going to test you at your level of your pocketbook first. And he's going to adjust your faith realm right around your pocketbook. And it ain't going to happen any other way. You will not get adjusted outside of your pocketbook. People just love this message. That's why I love ministering on it. Everyone is so excited about this message. No, especially those entrapped in the world, you know. They're just like, what are you so talking about? I'm talking about you give with abandonment. I love, and I'm releasing right now my commentary in the first epistle of John. Chris and Jeremiah is helping on the editing in Joshua. And I love, after going through that intense epistle with all of the proofs, I love hearing John tell Gaius and his fellow laborers how that they are in the truth. And he's got the proofs of it. And all sinners around that they spend their life making money to support the ministry. That's pretty radical stuff, ain't it? Oh, yeah. I love that one. I need to preach on that more. Hallelujah. That's that place where John says, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health, even as you so prosper. And everybody goes, oh, yes, praise God. Oh, he's talking to Gaius. He's not talking to you. He's talking to Gaius. You're going to have to act like Gaius. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Everybody wants, the Lord shall provide all that you have need of according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. He's talking to the Macedonian church at Philippi. Read about them in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. They made themselves poor taking care of the ministry. They want to lay claim to stuff out of context to their life. They not conformed. They want to say, I got this, I got that. No! And I can give you examples after example after example about every dimension of the blessings in the life of God. And it will cost you everything to inherit all that he has. It costs you everything. He should be willing, gladly willing to pay. Because you're already dead and your life is hid with God in Christ. And so everything that you have, is his. I love to tell it people like this. Somebody puts a gun to your head and says, give me all your money. You will gladly give them all of your money, for your life is more important to you than your money. So we've really exposed your heart. If you're dead with him, all that you have is his. If you're not dead with him, you're going to argue with him. You're going to feel cheated. You're going to feel robbed. You're going to feel weird. You're going to feel stingy. You're going to feel like somebody put too much pressure on you. And the reason I'm talking like this is because I want everybody tonight to move in faith with this thing. I want you to see God. I want you to understand it is absolutely what he demands. And what he demands, I'm going to tell you right now, those who participate with are going to find out how great of a rewarder he is, because he's demanding things of us so that he can bless us. He's going to take it one step at a time, but ultimately he's going to say, take now your son, your only son whom your soul loves, and offer him on an altar that I will show you. Because I'm going to see what part of your life you're going to hold back from me. And then he's going to stand up and he's going to say, now I know that you are my friend and that there is nothing that you withhold from me. Therefore, blessing I shall bless you. Because there's nothing greater to swear by, I swear by myself. Come on now. Somebody said, I thought it was all free in Jesus. It is. It's all free so that we can now have the right and the privilege to participate. It's all free so we can come on in and now be a part of a relationship with him and be developed by him to inherit all things. And I want you walking out here tonight knowing that's who you are and that's what you got, and you can prove God, and he's going to always show himself to be standing in the midst of his word. Not in the midst of your opinion or my opinion, not in the midst of what we think he should do for us, and after all, look at all of our sacrifices, but in the midst of what he said. So tonight, I want you to just come. I want you to get ready with this worship. It's worship. And you know that. You know. Listen, I want to say this one thing before you come. Vayechra. Vayechra, we call it Leviticus, but that's the opening. That's what, in Hebrew, that's what you call that book. Vayechra. And Vayechra simply means this. And he called. Anyone who wants to get close to me, as close as you possibly can get to me, let him bring his offering and come stand here at the door. That's worship. I'll bring my offering. I'm going to come stand by the door of Christ Jesus. I'm going to behold the glory. I'm not going to have to peer through the cracks, because the door is wide open. Are you with me? Come on, people. It's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. And there's a miracle in the house. Did you notice? I don't know if you discerned it or saw it, but I noticed it last night especially, that when people started walking by the offering basket, many different people began to become under a greater arresting power of the Spirit of the Lord. Did you notice that? That's a little witness. The Father's saying, I delight in this thing that you're doing. I'm gonna break you open into a whole nother realm of divine provision. I'm gonna show you how to walk in the gift of faith. I'm gonna show you how to call things into existence, to say things and speak things into existence. To stand up in this wonderful place in relationship with the Lord. I was telling Richard, I just got to tell this. I was telling Richard when he was here. I said, Richard, you never heard the whole story. And he had a person with him. I said, you know, all that God has done through us over the years in the nation of Nepal and the awakening that came to a nation. And I said, here's what happened. I said, Richard spoke on the phone to me. And when he was speaking on the phone to me about him going to Nepal, but he wasn't sure, suddenly, through the transmission of that word, God caused a gift of faith to come into me. A gift of faith exploded into me, and I realized that I was going. The next morning, supernaturally, a pastor in the Assemblies of God came over to visit me. He never comes to visit me. And he walked in the door, and I said, hey, you know, I think I'm going to Nepal. I don't know anybody in Nepal. He said, I know somebody in Nepal. Writes down his telephone number, hears his name, and he leaves. And that's all they came for. I call up the person. I said, hey, my name is Mark. The Lord's sending me to Nepal. Why do you want to come to Nepal? The Lord's sending me to Nepal. Why do you want to come to Nepal? To reach the lost. And he's basically, I don't really think you want to come here. It's really, you know. Because I didn't say, hey, you know, I'm this and that and the other. I said, my name is Mark from San Diego. That night, the Lord gives him a supernatural dream. He calls me up the next morning and says, who are you? I just want you to know, I will do whatever you want me to do. You tell me. And he worked so hard for us, 2006. See, it's just so simple. It was so simple. I was out cleaning horse stalls, faithfully doing what God had told me to do. And these things, I had learned how to move in faith. I had learned how to hear faith. I had learned how to be faithful to God. People want to go all over the place doing all these various different things. Stay right where you are. Wait for the apostolic things to begin to transpire in the midst of the church. If you were actually on the road to Damascus and saw heavenly vision and Jesus came and appeared to you and told you that he'd given you the power to turn men from Satan to God, from darkness to light, to open up the eyes of the blind, stay in the church until they say about 14 years later, separate unto me Paul and Barnabas for the work whereunto that I have called them. And then after they had fasted and prayed, they laid hands on them. I'm going for that. I will not compromise. I will not look for a shortcut. I will not go up any other way. I will not try to force any other thing upon it, God or what. I'm going to stay right here, and I'm going to seek him, and I'm going to cry out. Somebody say, how long you wait? How long you can wait? As long as it takes. I've been offered so many. Listen, I'm going to tell you this. I've been offered so many positions in famous ministries, positions that I had Carlos Anaconda say to me one time, I want you to start doing crusades for me in Argentina. That would have been right off the start off the bat. That would have been 30 to 40,000 people. I've on and on. In the early days, I had Rodney wanting me to come to Tampa, and I love him. I love him with all of my heart. He's a dear friend. There was a time where our Rodney and I were the best friends. I love him. But I stayed put. The list goes on and on. Can you just go after seeking God? I'm going for something bigger than any man can give me. I'm like, you know, like Elisha says, I want double what you have. In other words, he wasn't talking to Elijah no more. Because nobody can give you double what they got. They can only give you what they got. Huh? And the laws of physics says that they can only give you less than what they got. Huh? All you physicists agree, right? They can only give you less than what they got. He said, I want double what you got. So now he's talking to Papa. Are you listening to me? People are coming and coming over here. The Lord says, you seek me, and I'm going to tell you right now, Father's going to do something for you so that greater works. See, the context is Father. If you don't believe me for the word, believe the works, because it's Father that does the works. And anyone who believes, they should do these works and greater works. A revelation of Father. Oh, I don't want to get into that tonight. But I'm just letting you know, I'm just going for this. I want you. You're going to go for this. I'm not going to stand around and watch you cheat yourself. I'm going to rebuke you and correct you and instruct you with all authority. I'm going to love you with the love of Christ Jesus and lay down my life for you with all lowliness and meekness. Amen. Praise God. And I'm glad all of you. I'm glad all of you believe it. And we love the Lord. And I know you do too, so come worship him.